From coast to coast, live via satellite, it's time to praise the Lord. Major Christian events in America and across the world, covering over 500 million souls with the good news of new life in Jesus Christ. Now, from Southern California, we invite you to be a part of the world's largest prayer and praise gathering. Joining us on Praise the Lord, the host of Catholic Good News, Catholic lay evangelist Charlie Osborne. Well-known author and teacher of faith, Reverend Norval Hayes. Ministering in music, the pride of the island, the Hawaiian. Ready to take your call, some of the most beautiful prayer partners in the world. Now your host, world-renowned evangelist and recording artist, Dwight Centineo.
Thank you, Jim McClellan, and we welcome you tonight to a program that I believe has been designed of God to minister to the needs of many, many people. No matter what your need is, we have people tonight on this program that know how to minister to you in the power of the Holy Spirit. I want to get to it real quickly. We're delighted and thrilled to have Reverend Norval Hayes. He's the author of many, many books. He's a tremendous preacher of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, a powerful faith teacher. And he's anointed in the area of deliverance. Yeah. God has used him in such a tremendous, dynamic way. And he's going to touch lives tonight through the power of the ministry of the Word of the living God. In fact, I wished Norval would come up here right now. I want to just talk to him for a minute. And also, we're delighted to have a man that I'm excited about talking to because he's Mr. Enthusiasm. I'm talking about Reverend Charles Osborne, who is a lay evangelist in the Catholic Church, and he's being used of God. Some of the great moves of the Spirit are taking place as a result of his ministry. And we're so honored and delighted to have him tonight, and he has a tremendous program here on Praise the Lord. Our special singing guests, and when you get to harmony, nobody can do it like family can do it. And I'm talking about the Hawaiians, and we're delighted they're with us tonight. Let's give, just before they sing for us, I want Norval Hayes to come up here right now, if he will. Give him a great big hand. Welcome him to Praise the Lord. How you doing? Good to have you.
Thank you very much.
It is good to have you.
It's been a long time.
Yes, it
has.
I just wanted to tell you we're thrilled to have you on this program.
Oh, thank you, Dwight. Last time I was on here, I was on here with you and Zonell.
We're glad you're back.
Thank you.
What do you feel tonight? What are we going to get into? I want you to get into the area that you feel directed of the Holy Spirit tonight.
I feel like winning people to Jesus.
Amen.
Being free from sin.
I have a special request. Okay. I want you to tell about your daughter that was unsaved. Because today I talked to a lady in Palm Springs, and she's watching tonight because she's believing for the salvation of her son who is 30 years old. He's in drugs. And I told her, I said, you be sure and watch tonight.
Okay.
Praise
sure
God.
We'll get into
Amen.
It.
Amen.
Well, God can do anything, and no matter what your need is, this man is anointed of God to come against the powers of the devil. Revelation 12 and 11 says, they overcame him, the devil, by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony.
Hallelujah.
I believe that. The Word also says in 1 John 3 and 8, for this purpose the Son of God was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil. Hmm. Colossians 2:15 says, having spoiled principalities and powers, Jesus made a show of him, who? The devil, openly, triumphing over him in it. Mm-hmm. John 10 and 10 says that the thief comes to kill and steal and to destroy. That's his goal in life. In your life is to destroy. Destroy what God has given you. He's to steal everything that God's given you. He'll steal your family, your home, your fortune, your health, your mind, everything that he can. That's what Satan has come to do. Jesus said, I've come to give you life.
Hallelujah.
and give you the more abundant life. We're going to get into a lot of that tonight.
Yes, sir.
And I just want you to feel directed of the Holy Spirit.
Okay.
Let's welcome right now the Hawaiians. They're going to sing for you, and you're going to love their singing. If you've never heard them, you're going to hear some great singing. Please give them a great big hand. They're going to sing "There Is Someone." The Hawaiians.
Song's a song that we've been singing for the last 17 years that we've been in ministry here in what we call the mainland. But I don't know if you know this, but Norville Hayes recorded our first three albums, and it was in a situation that we never would have expected to have happened to us, but because we were living in Honolulu at the time, and Norville heard me sing at a Full Gospel Businessmen's Convention in Phoenix, Arizona. Remember that, Norval? And invited me to fly over to Cleveland, Tennessee. And we did this album together and did two more albums after that. And the Lord called us into this ministry as a result. So we really thank the Lord for men like Norval. And at that time, there weren't a whole lot of people who knew him and didn't know us either. But God has done a lot of things in all of us, and has been glorified and magnified through our separate ministries. And I'd like to sing this song that we sang on one of those albums. And those albums are now out of print. They have been out of print for many years. And I'd like to dedicate this to our dear brother, Norman. Bless you, brother. So long I had searched for life's meaning, enslaved by the world and my greed. When the doors of my prison were opened, my love for ransom was paid. I was free. I'm free from the fears of tomorrow.
dull empty life, I'm set free. For when I met Jesus and he made me complete, he forgot the foolish man I used to be.
Mark, do another verse of that, will you? Or one of the same verses. To him the Son hath set free, they are free. You want to talk about bondage. Someone said, is serving Jesus hard? Well, the Bible says that the way of the transgressor is hard.
That's right.
Jesus said, my yoke is easy, my burden is light. There's nothing on this planet that is more difficult than to struggle with a life of rebellion and sin and guilt and try and carry that load. There's nothing more free and exhilarating and thrilling than to be totally liberated from the power of sin. Romans chapter 8 verse 1 says, there is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Verse 2, the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus hath made me free from the law of sin and death.
Amen.
You know why Mark sings with his hands lifted toward heaven? Because he's free. There's nothing in the world like it than to be free. Tonight, you may be bound, but in a moment, if you will let Jesus do it, he's going to set you free. And you're going to lift your hand singing what Mark is singing, that I'm free. Open your heart right now while Mark sings another verse to this great song.
So long I had searched for life's meaning, but I was enslaved by the world and my greed. But the doors of my prison were opened by love, for a ransom was paid. I was freed. I'm free from the fears of tomorrow. I'm free from the guilt of my past.
I feel, before we get into ministry with Narvel Hayes, he knows, I know what it means to follow the Spirit of God. I've given as many altar calls by the time of the first song, probably, maybe as anybody, because I know when the Spirit of God moves, you move with it. People are ready to come to God now, right now. You don't have to wait for a sermon. You don't have to wait for a message. You don't have to wait for a story or an illustration. The Spirit of God is ready to touch you now. If you want to know this freedom that Mark sings about, you say, Dwight, I want to know Christ as my Savior. I want to be free. If you've been in any of my meetings across this country, you will know I do not give altar calls with salvation for salvation with heads bowed or eyes closed. I don't find any scripture for that. Anybody that says bow your heads and close your eyes and put your hands up and take them down, nobody will see them and nobody will ever know. I just don't find any verification of that in the scripture. It's not in there. Jesus said in Matthew 10:32 that if you will confess me before men, I will confess you before my Father. Verse 33, he said, but if you deny me before men, I will deny you before my Father which is in heaven. He further said that if you're ashamed of me, I'll be ashamed of you. There's no place in the Bible you can find to support that pattern of salvation that says put your hand up, take it down, nobody will see it. Nobody will ever know. That's why we have secret service Christians across this land. That's not what the Bible said. Jesus said, publicly confess me.
Amen.
As your Savior and as your Lord. We ought to get on the housetop shouting it.
Yes.
If these folks can come out of the closet and declare they're proud to be gay, I think it's about time that we that are born again through the blood of Jesus Christ ought to shout it to the housetop that we're proud to be born again.
Amen.
I want you to know tonight that Christ Jesus will set you totally and completely free. And I want Amen. You to pray this prayer with me out loud. Amen. Do it right now. When I give altar calls for salvation, I have everybody open their eyes and look around. We're going to see who really wants to know Christ as your Savior and Lord. Mark, if you will, sing one more verse in that chorus again. I just feel led of the Spirit of God right here. Pray this prayer with me out loud. In fact, I'm going to ask Narvel and Zonel, if they would please, just to repeat this after me.
Okay.
If you're tired of the sin, you're tired of defeat, you're tired of guilt, you're tired of being a loser, and you want to be a winner, give your life to Jesus right now. Pray this prayer with me out loud. Dear Lord Jesus,
dear Lord Jesus,
I come to you a sinner.
I come to you a sinner.
I am a sinner.
I admit it.
I repent of my sin.
I repent of my sin.
I ask you to forgive me.
I ask you to forgive.
Come into my heart.
Come into my heart.
And into my life.
Into my life.
Set me free.
Set me free.
I confess that Jesus Christ.
I confess that Jesus Christ,
the Son of God,
the Son of God,
is the Savior,
is the Savior,
the only Savior,
the only Savior,
my Savior,
my Savior.
I reject all other gods.
I reject all other gods.
And I receive the true and the living God.
And I receive the true and living
Goodbye,
God.
Goodbye, Satan.
Goodbye, Satan.
Goodbye, sin.
Goodbye, sin.
I pledge my life.
I pledge my life.
And my allegiance.
My allegiance
to Jesus Christ.
To Jesus Christ.
And I'm free.
I'm free.
Thank God.
Thank God.
I'm free.
Free.
Amen. I'm free.
Amen.
I'm free. Go to your telephones, if you will, right now. There's a number that's on your screen. I want you to go to that phone, if you would, please, and just share it now with someone and let us know what God has done in your heart and in your life. If you've got to go wake up somebody, you need to tell somebody you've been born again. If you've got to get on the phone and call an operator, tell somebody I've been born again. Or get out on the porch and shout it to your neighbor that I've been born again. This is the most exciting day of your life. You're free. You really are. You're free.
Amen.
Listen to Mark while he sings it for us one more time. Call me. I'm waiting on your call right now.
I'm free from the fears of tomorrow. And I'm free from the guilt of my past. For I've trained my shackles for a glory.
the guilt that I carried, from the dull, empty life I'm set free. For when I met Jesus and He made me complete, He forgot the foolish man I used to be. Oh, I'm free from the fears of all my tomorrows, 'cause I'm free, free from the guilt of all my past. Oh, I've traded my shackles for a glorious time. I'm free.
Just a few moments, we've prayed this prayer. Linda has called in from Spokane, Washington.
Praise God.
She has prayed the sinner's prayer. She's come to Jesus Christ. Stella in Desert Hot Springs, California, 70 years young. Tonight she's born again through the blood of Jesus Christ. Anthony in Miami, Florida is 26, and she said yes to God. Teresa in Anaheim, California has already called and said, I'm free. Thank you, Lord. Cher in Bakersfield, California. Well, she said, I was a Jehovah Witness, but now I'm really a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ, born again through the blood of Jesus Christ. David in Cincinnati, Ohio is 25, and he's been born again tonight through the blood of Jesus. Neil in Ohio, Nabarro, Ohio, 40 years of age, has rededicated their life to the Lord tonight. And Kenneth in Hawthorne, California, has called and said, yes, I've recommitted my life to Jesus. Let's praise God for it, can we? That's what it's about.
That's right, brother.
What it's about. Well,
that's wonderful.
Feel a little fired up tonight, don't you?
Yeah. Feel like starting a meeting, getting blessed myself.
Yeah, I know that feeling. Hallelujah.
Seems like old times, Mark, being with Mark again.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mark and me spent a lot of meetings together.
Yeah.
I took him to his first 26 concerts he put on in this country.
Is that right?
I went with him, every one of them.
Yeah.
From Hawaii.
Yeah, when he first came over here. Never did get tired of hearing him sing.
Mm-mm.
He sung the same songs nearly every concert.
Mm-hmm.
I liked him better at the end of the 26 concerts than even when it started.
Yeah. And old songs like that are tremendous.
Mm-hmm.
I love all the new songs. I love them all. Those old songs like that makes a statement.
Oh, yeah.
What do you feel in your spirit? I just want you to obey God. God's got some things on your heart for us tonight, and we're ready.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I think we want to talk about kids getting delivered from dope. It seems like the Lord's leading along that line, you know?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of young people out there that's dying, you know?
Yeah.
A lot of them.
You have a daughter, and she's a powerful witness
for
Jesus Christ.
Yes, she is.
And something marvelous happened in her life because her dad stood in the gap, literally, and told the devil to get his hands off of that child.
3.5 years.
Talk about it for us.
3.5 years, quite. She was on drugs. She started, you know, when she's about 19 years of age. And her and Bobby got married, and he was overseas in Vietnam, and she got a letter from him one day that upset her, and she began to scream and run through the parking lot. At that moment, the devils came into her. And so when she did, when it happened, she got in a gang in our hometown, and she stayed in that gang for 3.5 years. And she got on drugs, and sometimes I'd see her every 2 or 3 weeks, and sometimes she'd come home at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, and sometimes she wouldn't. Sometimes she wouldn't come home for 2 or 3 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
But I kept on praying for her, And she just wouldn't give up. She wouldn't go to church. She wouldn't do nothing. absolutely do nothing. Mm-hmm. I kept on praying for her, standing the gap for her. I bring different people at the house to talk to her, all kinds of nationally known ministers to talk to her. And she would listen to them, but she wouldn't change. Mm-hmm. No changing for her. Mm-hmm. And the longer it went, the harder she got. Then one of her friends, little friends, died in overdosing on drugs. And that got me kind of shook up, you know. Mm-hmm. And I just kept on praying harder and stronger. And then a couple of months later, another one died. And that lasted over the 3.5 year span. She had 5 of her little friends that we buried that overdosed on drugs, 5 of them. And I got to the point when the phone would ring, the devil would say to me, "That's your daughter and she's next."
Yeah.
And so I just kept on binding the devil and walking the floor and praying, making intercession. I said, "No, no, Satan, you'll never take my daughter to hell. You never will. You can't have my daughter. In Jesus' name, you can't have my daughter." Yeah. And I just kept on praying, kept on praying, and kept on praying. And she got so hard, right, her mind got so hard you couldn't reach her. Mm-hmm. And the thing that, you know, I thought I was right by, you know, telling her what to do and so forth, you know, and trying to keep her in line, everything, you know, and her coming at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, trying to get her not to do that, you know. And so I thought I had a right to act like her daddy. I didn't see her for 3 or 4 weeks, and she'd come in, and she'd say things to me like, you know, "Well, Daddy, where you going next weekend? Where you going this weekend? Denver, Colorado? Where you going next weekend? Los Angeles, California? Where you going next weekend? New York?" But it makes you feel funny, Daddy, going around the country winning other men's kids to God and can't even win your own.
Yeah. She'd say that to you?
Yeah.
Had she known the Lord before that?
Yes. But her mind was so seared over,
yeah,
like a hot iron. You couldn't reach her. Mm-hmm. I mean, she was like talking to a zombie, like talking to that wall over there. Nobody couldn't reach her. Mm-hmm. Had all kind of nationally known ministers, my friends, to come in and talk to her.
Norval, can I interrupt you right here and make this observation? I feel led of the Spirit of God. There's a scripture in the Bible that said the sins of Judah were written with a pen of iron. And what that really denoted was that this was so indelibly imprinted. Sin is so indelibly imprinted.
Yes.
It is impossible to remove it.
That's right.
And when a person becomes so ingrained and engrafted, if you will, into sin, then that sin becomes permanently fixed into their spirit, and the only person can set them free is Jesus Christ. And that's what happens when you were talking about that. She couldn't get free from this. It was so in her spirit.
No, she couldn't get free. And you know, sometimes we go along, we teach the Bible, and we do this and do that, you know, and have salvation services and pray for the sick and different things. And even though while you're doing this, you're close to God, and you see the Lord work mightily, you know, but you got to take up, you got to take stock and take inventory of yourself. Mm-hmm. Sometimes. And sometimes, right, we get so busy working for God, sometimes we don't know the Lord as well as we should know Him.
Yeah.
And go back to and put first things first. Now, the thing that got it started on the road of victory, because I was praying so hard and I wanted to know the truth, I was in San Antonio, Texas, holding a 10-day meeting. There was 2 churches invited me to come to San Antonio, one on the north side of town, one on the south side of town. Mm-hmm. They wanted to come up here and teach for 3 or 4 days on the south side and so forth. They'd take me to a different church every morning over the city, and I'd speak to them. I did that for 10 days, and I was so tired. And a fellow brought missionaries brought his wife there. She's devil-possessed, and I wrote the prayer of the devil over her. And he saw his wife get free, and he asked me, he says, "Mr. Hayes, when this meeting is over," he says, will you ride to Houston with us?" And I says, "Well, okay, I need to go to Houston anyway, and I'll ride to Houston with you." I was sitting in a room, and across the street from the Astrodome in a motel room, and the Spirit of the Lord, I was going to catch a plane, go to Chattanooga, Tennessee, back home. I need to go home. I'd been gone for 10 days. I'm going to catch a plane in 15 minutes. I was going to leave. These missionaries were going to take me to the airport. I'm sitting there like this in a chair, Dwight, and the Spirit of the Lord moved on me, supernaturally. Mm-hmm. And the Spirit of God started bulling up out of me. And the Spirit of God said to me, just as plain, says, "Go to Tulsa, Oklahoma for me, and I'll show you 2 things after you get there." I said, all right. Mm-hmm. I said, I'm tired, Lord, but I need to go home. But if you want me to go that bad, I said, I'll go. Well, in those days, Dwight, I knew three people in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I knew Kenneth Hagin and Oral Roberts and a millionaire named Ford, a man named Ford, mm-hmm. that helped Demas Sakarian establish the Full Gospel of Business Ministry chapters. Mm-hmm. That's the only three people in Tulsa in those days that I knew. I've always thought, I've always wondered, Dwight, if I had not obeyed God, if this would have happened to me or not. I'm riding to Tulsa, Oklahoma from Houston, Texas, and all of us, and I'm riding with the Assembly of God. Did you ever know a couple named Reverend and Mrs. Goodwin?
From
Pasadena, Texas?
Yeah, very much.
Okay, I'm riding mm-hmm. in a car with them. We're all three riding towards Tulsa. They lived in Houston. They'd called me up and wanted me to see them, and I'm going to Tulsa, and they're going to go with me. So then we take their car and go to Tulsa. Mm-hmm. And before we was riding down the road, just having a good, pleasant time. And all of a sudden, the Spirit of God came on her.
Sister Goodman.
Yeah, and she began to speak uh-huh. in other tongues uh-huh. in the car. And then he gave the interpretation. And he gave the interpretation, it was to me. He gave the interpretation, I broke and began to cry. And the Lord told me, he said, son, the thing I want all the parents and people to listen closely and get this. He said, the thing that you want more than anything in the world will never happen until you change.
Well,
I was sobbing and crying.
Yeah. Yeah.
Spirit of God was all over me until I changed. And then he told me what to do. I mean, right in the interpretation, told me what to do. He said, you must start loving your daughter more, and you must start telling her that you love her more. I know, my son, that you love your daughter. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I know how your heart aches for her freedom. But you must start telling her. He said, words creates reality. Mm-hmm. You must start telling her that you love her. Tell her two things. Tell her you love her every day. And tell her I love her. And then you shut up. I'd been saying, you know what'd you do this for?
Yeah.
You know, Daddy.
Yeah.
You know, I'm her father. I want to act like one. But Jesus wanted me to act like
yeah.
him.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, see? Yeah. Yeah, he wanted me to act like him. So she'd come in. It was hard on me, Dwight, when I first started. I'd wait up till 2 o'clock in the morning, she wouldn't come in. And maybe 3 o'clock in the morning I'd hear her come in or something. And I'd wake up and I'd say, Zona, come here, honey. Here in her room. She'd say, what do you want, Daddy? I'd say, well, just come to my door, Zona. Come to my door, let me talk to you, honey. I got something I want to tell you. And she'd come to my door and she'd say, look off like this. She'd say, okay, Daddy, what do you want? I said, I just want to tell you, Zona, that I love you, honey, and Jesus loves you. Hmm. And she'd stand there, you know, and look off and say, is that all, Daddy? Can I go now? I'd say, yeah, you can go. And I told her every day. Hmm. About 6 months, Dwight. Spirit of God is really going to do some work tonight.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Believe that.
He's going to set people free, totally free. And they can be free, and the parents can help the children get free if they'll just listen closely. And about 6 months goes by, and I keep on praying and keep on praying and keep on praying and telling the devil he can't have my daughter. And I kept telling her every day that I loved her. After she was hard as nails, you couldn't get to her, nothing couldn't get to her, nothing couldn't reach mm-hmm. her. Mm-hmm. And after 6 months of me telling her that, one day, you know what it is to have your child, Dwight, on dope and no hope for? Five of her friends has died, and they're in the grave now. Five sharp young people dead in the grave. Mm-hmm. And it looks like there's no hope at all for your child to ever be free from that, from dope. And you know what it is to how you feel to see a little spark of hope? After 6 months of that, one day in my living room, there's two gold velvet chairs, one sitting here and one sitting over there. And I never will forget, I called in, and she was sitting in one of those chairs. She says, Daddy, she was waiting on the gang to come and pick her up to go to the Playmate Club. Mm-hmm. And she says, Daddy? I says, I went to the door and I said, yes, Donna, what do you want, honey? She said, looking off from me, you know, not looking, she wasn't looking at me. She says, Daddy, I know that you love me. Well, you haven't heard anything like that in 3.5 years. Mm-hmm. It's like a whole world opened up to you, you know.
Yeah.
She said, I know that you love me. And she said, I know the people I run with don't love me, Daddy. And I'm getting to the point where I don't want to go to the Playmate Club anymore, Daddy. I'm getting to the point that I don't like to leave this house. Daddy, I love our house. There's such security in this house. There's such security, Daddy, when I'm around you. She says, I feel pure, clean love in this house all the time. And I don't want to leave it. I'm getting to the point, Daddy, I don't want to leave it. I don't want to leave it. I said, well, honey, you don't have to leave it. Just stay here tonight. She says, well, and she says, I said, well, Zona, what would God have to do, honey, to get you to come back to him, darling? She said, I don't know, Daddy. Knock me down, I guess. I said, you know, he could do that. About that time, the car pulled up in the driveway with a gutted muffler. You know how teenagers are. You know it's on dope. And she got up and said, Zona, you don't have to go, honey. You don't have to go tonight. And she says, I guess I better go. They've come. And so she went out and got in the car. I walked out on the porch. I let the devil know. I said, you can't have my daughter, you thief. I bind you in Jesus' name. And I began to yell, Satan, you can't have my daughter. You'll never take my daughter to hell. You can't turn my daughter loose.
Amen.
Satan, you can't have my daughter. Yeah. And I began to yell at him, you know, and yell at him and yell at him. And that same day, I went back in the house. I began walking backwards and forth, and I was praying. And just as plain, it came to me while I was praying, and a voice said to me, just as plain, you've never laid your hands on her bed and prayed. So I wheeled around all of a sudden, went in her room. I laid my hands on her bed. I said, oh, God, I said, I give Zona to you, Lord. I said, my daughter belongs to you, and I lay my hands on her bed. And I ask you, Lord, when she lays in this bed, that you shake her up. God, I pray that you'd shake her foundation. And I caught myself, a voice coming out of me praying. There's a voice started coming out of me praying so strong. Oh, God, shake her up when she lays in this bed tonight. Oh, God, shake her mind, shake her foundation. Oh, God, shake her when she lays in this bed tonight. Shake my daughter up, Jesus. She's yours. I give her to you totally. Shake her up, Jesus. Please, oh, God, shake her foundation. Shake her up, Jesus. I remember I sat up that night at about 2 o'clock, a little after 2 o'clock before I went to bed. She never did come in, so I went on to bed. And something woke me up, you know, in a few hours. I woke up and I heard a little voice. I heard a little voice saying, and it sounded like it was a way off. And the little voice said, Daddy. I could hear it say, Daddy, Daddy. And I said, that sounds like my daughter. I get up out of the bed, go to the door, and open the door. And I've never seen a human being, Dwight, that scared in my life. She was standing in front of my bedroom door like this. Daddy, Daddy, Daddy. She could not get the voice out, little squeaky voice. Mm-hmm. Just, Daddy. I've never seen a human being that scared in my life. I said, what in the world's happened to you? She said, Daddy, in my room, a man in my room. Daddy, you're going to die. And she was trying to tell me, and she couldn't for shaking, so I had to grab her and shake her. I shook her. I said, Zona, stop it, honey. Talk to me. What in the world is wrong with you? And she said, Daddy, man in my room. No, not a man. He's big, 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 Daddy. He's big. I said, what's big, honey? What do you mean a man in your room? I felt the peace of God all over me.
Yeah.
I says, what do you mean, a man in your room? I says, is there a man in your room now? She says, no, he's gone. He disappeared. He walked through the wall. I says, what do you mean, walk through the wall? Well, a man, Daddy, I could have died, man. He's, well, no, Daddy, not a man. He's big, Daddy, he's big. Two men. And she's still shaking like this, her voice. She says, two men. And all of a sudden, this came to me. The Lord just reminded me of that scripture. You better watch how you entertain people, because you could be entertaining an angel right in your midst. And it's very scriptural, in fact, that God himself can put meat on an angel and have him appear as a man. Mm-hmm. And take it off when he pleases. You know, when you're God, you can do anything you want to do.
Yeah, sure can.
And so I knew that's what happened. So now I said, okay, Zona. I says, tell me, honey, what happened? Went in her room. She says, this is Daddy. I'm laying in the bed. And she says, I'm looking over, and I thought I was dreaming. You know, she says, I thought I was dreaming, but I wasn't dreaming. She says, I looked over, and this big man was sitting in the floor, and he's sitting like this, with his legs, sitting on top of his legs and his arms like this. He's sitting there looking at me. And I thought I was dreaming, sitting in my room by my bed looking at me. And he was as big as two men. I never seen a human being that big in my life. And she says, and I knew I was dreaming. And I turned my head back over like this. And then I looked at the wall of my room. And I says, no, this is my wall. I'm in my daddy's house. And my name is Zona Hayes. I'm the daughter of Norville Hayes. And she said, in the cover of my bedspread, she says, up over like this. She says, well, this is my bedspread on my bed. And she's like this, and she says, I'm not dreaming. Mm. And she looked back around like this, and he was still sitting there. And she got so scared, and she said, I went to trying to scream for you, Daddy. And I was so scared. He was so big, opened up my mouth, and I went, and she says, nothing wouldn't come out. I was so scared. And she said, I couldn't hardly get my breath. I was so scared. I'd never been so scared in my life. She said, He saw I was scared, and I couldn't hardly breathe. I was so scared. And said he just got up real nice, just got up off of his legs, stood up. And Daddy, who was a lot taller than the door and didn't even bend over, he just walked through the door and didn't even bend over. And I jumped up out of the bed, and I went to the door, and I watched him. He walked down the hallway, and I watched him walk down the hall. When he got even with the kitchen, he just turned and walked through the wall, right in through the air, right over the top of the houses, and went out of sight. Just walked through the air, walked through the wall. And I says, you know what that was, Zona? She says, no, I don't know what it was. I said, Zona, honey, I said, that was your angel. Yeah. I said, she says, Daddy, I don't want him. He's too big. He scares me. I said, Zona, he goes with you everywhere. She says, yeah. Daddy, don't say that. It scares me. Don't say that to me. Don't say that to me, Daddy. Don't say that. I said, he does. He goes with you everywhere. She says, Daddy, please. Please don't say that. I said, well, he does. Thank God he came in tonight. I said, thank God he came in tonight. She said, Daddy, I can't stand it. I can't stand it. And she falling on her face on the floor and screaming out to God for mercy, you know, and asking God to help her. And God began to help her and set her totally free. From that night forward, she never has to take one bit of dope. God sent her angel into her room and scared all the dope devils out of her.
You know what? That's what I thought about. It just scared her out of her.
It did.
Yeah. I mean, she was scared, and the devil was scared, and everything in her was scared.
Well, you know those old sayings before we got saved, you know, everybody know having the weather, that scared the hell out of me, scared the hell out of her. I'll tell you that. The devil's out of her, boy.
Christ
the hell that was in her scared it out of her. I mean, scared the hell, demons, everything else out of her. Boy, she had a lot of hell and demons both in her. I'm telling you, she wouldn't go to church. She wouldn't do nothing.
But it scared them all out, didn't it?
Scared them all out, and they left.
Praise God, everybody. Hallelujah. Pray for folks right now. Norma, what do you feel right now? Just in this camera, whatever you feel to minister and help.
Yes, all right. Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for every young person or every person that's on drugs, that devil and demon of drugs has dogged their tracks and possessed their minds, and they don't seem to be any way they can get off of it. And we know that there's thousands and thousands of them die every year on overdosing on drugs. Satan, I bind you, you foul, drug-murdering spirit that you hate young people. I bind you in Jesus' name, and I command you to take your hand off of the youth of America. Let them go free in Jesus' name. Let their minds go free. Father, I pray right now that every young person is listening to me, that the Spirit of God would go to them right now and go through their minds and give them a new mind that they could think straight and create a hunger in them for the Lord Jesus Christ and to be free totally from the appetite of drugs. I curse the appetite of drugs for every young person that's looking right now.
I curse
that appetite
and
command it to die in Jesus' name and leave that young person. They can be free and be a normal human being. You foul suicide spirit, I bind you and command you, come out of them and let them go free completely in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord, for your spirit going to them and setting them free and imparting to them eternal life. In Jesus' name. Young person, if you're watching right now, say, Father, please forgive me and set me free of drugs.
Yes.
Young person, you know as well as I do that the spirit of drugs is of the devil, and you know it's dogging your tracks, and it's taking your money, it's making you steal things, it's doing everything to fulfill that habit. I want you to rise up right now and say, Jesus, I belong to you by faith. And Jesus, I resist these drugs. I don't want these drugs. Jesus, take them away from me completely and take the appetite away from me completely for drugs. In Jesus' name, I resist every appetite in me for drugs, and I bind you and you go from me. Jesus, I love you and take my life, please, Lord, and take my life and use me and set me free from this thing that dogs my tracks and tries to wreck my life and ruin me. Set me free, Jesus, tonight, I pray. Thank you, Lord, for doing it. Now then, begin to thank the Lord for setting you free. And call that number right now on the telephone, on the television screen. Call that number and give us a report that you are free from drugs. Call that number and let somebody minister to you over the phone. Would you do it? Do it right now.
Praise God, everybody. Praise God. The Hawaiians are ready to sing for us in just a moment, but I want to urge you to go to that telephone, as Norval has asked you to do, that we're set free by the power of God. Go to that phone and tell us what God has done for you, and give Him praise and give Him glory.
Thank you, Jesus.
You know, this will shock many people. I read some time ago that the defense budget of the United States is somewhere in the $400 billion bracket. $400 billion. It astounds me when I get a figure on what people in America spend on illegal drugs. It's nearly half that amount.
Oh, it's staggering.
It's nearly at the $200 billion that Americans spend on illegal drugs.
And right now, Dwight, let me pass this on to you. Right now, I just heard this. There's more young people now committing suicide than any other time in the history of the world, even as low as 8 years old. You know, in these big cities, Dwight, a lot of young people get on drugs at 8 and 9 years old. They're selling their bodies to fulfill the habit at 12 and 13 years old. And there's more young people losing out of their thinking and committing suicide in history, getting on drugs and having their mind that. See, drugs will half blow your mind, Dwight. You can't think straight.
You know, Norval, I don't know that you know this, but the Lord has really placed it on our heart in the last couple of years, really, to where all of these meetings we've been having throughout the country, you're involved in them too.
Yes.
I do probably 15 major auditorium meetings a year, plus probably 200 churches a year. And I preached some time ago, and those that are watching, some will know this, I preached probably in April last year, my first message on the subject of teenage suicide in Riverside, California. What I didn't know then, that it was the tip of an iceberg, like nothing in all of my ministry that I've ever encountered. We were deluged with cards or letters and tens of thousands of pictures of somebody in that family that was had either committed suicide from a family member they would send it, or had attempted, or someone in that immediate family that were on drugs and attempted suicide. So I made up my mind we were going to do something about this. So on top of all these meetings, I've started having meetings directed primarily to the youth of America. Mm-hmm. I'm not a teenager anymore by a long shot, but I just get on a pair of old jeans and get out in the middle of them and rent big auditoriums, throw out lots of chairs. And I was trying to think the other day about this, thinking about this meeting at the convention center not very long ago. We put out, I think it was 4,000 chairs, because I didn't know what to expect. And I had a stage out there, and the place, they tell me, was packed and jammed 45 minutes before the meeting even started. And the kids came in, a lot of them had to sit on the floor and all of this. When the altar call was given, just like I gave it tonight, heads up, everybody looking around, 750 or so stood up and walked forward. I'm talking about kids. A lot of them were kids, young yes. children. Then I'm talking about older teenagers. And then I'm talking about people that really got into drugs in the decade of the 60s. Yeah. When we first had this when really a drug culture started, this revival of drugs throughout the nation became epidemic. Well, now we're talking about people my age in their 40s. We're talking about people that had been on drugs for 20 years. Mm-hmm. Now, in that meeting would be this altar call was expressly for those that had, and this is the way I gave it, serious, not casual. They tell us over 50% of all teenagers in America have what is known as serious suicidal thoughts. Mm. Well, I went beyond that. Not only were they serious suicidal thoughts, but you actually thought and considered, this is what I'll do to escape from your dilemma in life. Well, 750 out of that crowd of some 4,000 came out. I had couples come forward, my age now, husband and wife, that both were in drugs together. Three of these couples that I talked to after this meeting started out on light things like marijuana. They'd smoke a little pot and they'd graduate on to uppers and so on until they were popping reds and snorting cocaine and eventually even dropping acid. And then they came into where they were mainlining freebasing now.
Yeah.
Well, every one of these said to me these words. These 20 couples out of that bunch were my ages and had been on drugs for 20 years, married couples. And three of them had made up their mind they were taking a suicidal pact. They were both going to suicide together because they couldn't be free from this. Few people realize that according to Dr. Seymour Perlin, that over 2 million teenagers a year attempt suicide. Well, what happens is they reach a place, and the psychologists say why they do it is because they perceive that the situation that they're in and the life that they are in is so undesirable and so difficult and so intolerable that it's going to be this way all the time. In other words, they will never be free. From their perspective and where they are, what they say is there is no way out. Mm-hmm. So death becomes preferable to life. Well, what we're going to see, I've taken this thing in my spirit to task for the rest of my life. So from there we went on to Cincinnati with it, and I did it on a Monday night. Well, the story was the same. It literally was jammed with kids and young people, thousands of people that said, I want to be free by the power of God. Now, I want to tell you something. I believe tonight what Narvel Hayes has told us about his precious daughter, that if every parent, what can we do? Everybody's watching saying, what can we do? Well, let me tell you something. Prayer is a powerful force.
Yes.
And when you stand in the gap for those kids, we're not giving those kids over to God. Acts 16:31 says that I have a promise from the Lord. He said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, you shall be saved, and your house is coming to God. I want to tell you something. The devil's not going to come in and take those kids. And this epidemic that is out of the pit of hell, out of the sewer of hell, I have no doubt in my heart, out of the very pit of hell, I believe Satan Listen to this, Narva. Yeah. I believe Satan brings and dispatches demons daily from the pit of hell for certain assignments. And in this end time, as we are approaching the tremendous grand finale of all eternity, and that's the rapture of the church and the glorious return of the Lord, Satan's target, more than ever, are the teens of America.
That's right.
And the youth of America. You know why? He knows he's not going to talk Narval Hayes and getting him to change his mind about this commitment to the infallibility of the Word of God and this commitment to the saving grace of the power of Jesus and this commitment to Narval's allegiance to the Lord. He's not going to change my mind. He's not going to change a lot of seasoned Christians that are watching this. His target is the youth of America. Mm-hmm. If he can so destroy the minds of our young people, and when all of our generation is gone, should the Lord tarry that long, as far as he's concerned, he's achieved his purpose. And this what we have in America now called clustering suicides. I've said this before, but for those that don't know, more girls than boys attempt suicide, but more boys than girls succeed in taking their life. It's interesting to note that the second leading cause of death, not only among kids, but also among college students, is suicide. It's interesting to note, now they tell us, the experts, the number one leading cause of death among teenagers are accidents, accidental related deaths. But the experts are telling us now that they believe as many as 25 to 50% of the so-called accidents involving young people are not accidents at all. They believe they are self-destructive acts on the part of the kids because they simply, the parents or the authorities or whatever, it's a stigma, whatever you want to call it, they want to cover it up. Then it's having what we call the clustering effect or copycat suicide. And all across this nation, they're taking their lives by in dozens, if you will. A letter from the Assistant Attorney General in the state of Texas came to my office and addressed to me personally and said, "Mr. Thompson, I'm not even a religious man, but what we're doing is not working." He said, "If you'll come to the capital city of Texas, I'm not a religious man, but I will support your meeting because what you're doing seems to be the only answer." And it is the only answer. We're not going to see this tide of suicide change and this tide. Let me tell you something. I'm for everything they can do to stop the dope pushers in this nation.
Amen.
And you cannot believe how severely that I think men or women that are pushing dope to kids ought to be punished. I believe they ought to be taken off the streets and incarcerated for the rest of their life. I'm very adamant against what people are doing to the kids of this nation. But I also want to tell you this, the laws of this nation aren't really going to make a dent in it. It's going to take the Spirit and the power of God. We can come against the demons out of the forces of hell. We, the Church of Jesus Christ, can rise up like Narval did with his daughter. Think what could happen if every child of God, whether you're Baptist or Methodist or Catholic or Jewish or Pentecostal, if we stood up together in this hour through the power of the Holy Spirit and came against that in the power of the name of Jesus, I believe with my heart we can actually dry up the drug traffic in America if Christians will stand up and come against it in the power of the Holy Spirit. I believe that. Well, we're all kind of fired up about this tonight,
yes.
Harlow.
Amen.
And it's going to have to be just what you did on an individual basis with your daughter. We're going to have to do that across this nation.
Yeah, let me say one thing here, Dwight. Now, if parents have got children, many of them has children, that as far as their own knowledge is concerned, they just don't know. They don't know how to reach them. You know what I mean? You can't reach them. And I was in the same boat. But I am telling you that the love of Jesus is the strongest thing in the world.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The love of Jesus, strongest thing in the world. Mm-hmm. And let me say to all the parents that's listening, let me beg of you if I have to. Just because it's your child steals things to fulfill that habit or whatever they do to fulfill that habit, don't turn against that child. Begin to love them more than you've ever loved them. Not only begin to love them, you may be like me and say, "Oh, well, I know that. I know that I love my child. I love my child. I love my child." No, I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about that at all. I'm talking about you showing that child that you love them. If that child comes home once every 2 weeks, strung out on drugs and stuff, and just comes by once every 2 or 3 weeks, listen, mamas, if that child likes coconut pie, when they walk in the door, you make them one. They're going to stay one night or what? Anything that you can do to show that child that you love them and tell them that you love them and put your arms around them and just tell them that they're wonderful and keep on telling them. And keep on and on and on and on and on and on. I did it for 6 months before it ever penetrated and reached my daughter. But Jesus told me if I didn't change myself mm-hmm. and start loving my daughter the same way he loved me when I was mm-hmm. in sin. He reminded me, he said, I didn't turn against you when you were in sin.
Yeah.
And he said, I didn't warp you over the top of the head all the time when you were in sin. I was waiting for you to come to me any day that you would choose to come. I waited every day with a longing heart for you to come. I waited. He said, I want you to love your daughter the same way. Same way I loved you when you were in sin. And tell her every day that you love her. Every day. Because once that love begins to penetrate in them and they begin to decide, they can help, Dwight. Mm-hmm. I'm mm-hmm. telling you, they can help. Once they begin to see that somebody loves them, that's real. And the love is real. Mm-hmm. They start getting interested in love and coming back to reality again. They will get interested in it. Mm-hmm. But unless they see that, Dwight, and the power of the devil is broken through prayer, and they see pure love, they want no part of it.
Yeah.
You see what I mean?
Yeah, sure.
And I just want to encourage the parents. Don't turn against your child. I don't care the crazy, goofy things they've done. I don't have time. The night is not long enough for me to tell you all the goofy things my daughter did. Mm-hmm. But I am telling you, today I saw her go from a girl on dope that nobody could reach, from a sweet, precious girl. She wouldn't harm a fly. And if you was to mention, show her one dope pill, she'd say, no, not me. I'm not going to ever, no. She'd, mm-hmm. she'd just as strong against it as she mm-hmm. was for it. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And a lot of people think, well, Dwight, I've had them say this many times, well, Dwight, if I let them keep coming into the house, they're on drugs, they might think I approve of it. Or I'm condoning it, or it's all right. But that's really not even the issue here. There was I tell this story about this particular Pentecostal preacher that told me when this child came in that he had not seen in a year when I was preaching in a college some time ago, the 16-year-old girl that came in and demon possessed, bound by the powers of drugs, 16 years old, into prostitution, everything you can imagine. I heard unbelievable forces and demonic voices speaking out of this child. God set her free eventually in that meeting that night. But when the power of God was through with her, she is laying there just out under the power of the Holy Spirit. And a gray-haired gentleman came up. He was weeping. He was so distraught. He could hardly hold himself up. Threw himself on my shoulder, began to cry. He said, that's my daughter. Haven't seen her in over a year. And he said, it's my fault. And always remember this. I'll always remember this. If I live to be 100, the Lord should tarry. He said, Dwight, he said, when I came in, I was pastoring a church. When I came in and I saw what she was doing, she was smoking her pot and taking some stronger drugs. And I found this in her room. And I caught her doing that. And it's so infuriating. Here's what he said. The only thing I could think about was I was going to be disgraced in this town.
Yeah.
I'd be disgraced in my church. Mm-hmm. What will everybody think? And he began to think about it. And you think about it, it's a very selfish statement. They were all selfish. These are his words.
Oh, sure.
It's all selfish. What are they going to think about me?
Yes, sir.
I'll be asked to leave the church. I'll lose my position in the community. Da, 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 everything. And as a result, he slapped her. A little confrontation, slapped her. Said, if you're going to smoke this stuff, you're going to get out of this house because you're not going to embarrass me and all of this kind of thing. Well, the child left. And for a year, he's lived in a virtual hell, walking the floor night after night, wishing that he could turn the clock back and let her come in.
Yeah.
See? Mm-hmm. And anyway, the Lord did a tremendous miracle. But I'm here to tell you, it doesn't matter what they're doing. Narvel said it as well as you could say it. Keep the door open. If they like coconut pie, fix them a coconut pie. Because, see, the day will come when they'll run out of friends. They'll get sick of where they are.
Yeah, that's right.
The dope, after a while, when they run out of money, they're going to run out of the whatever they can get to get the stuff. All their buddies, when they quit sharing it, what it's going to do, it's going to run its course. And the only person that they truly believe that loves them for what they are, and who they are, I should say, is going to be the mom and the dad that kept the door open, that said, I love you, that kept the light on, that kept the covers pulled back, that kept their plate at the table no matter how many days or weeks it's been since they've been home. And when that happens, they're going to come home to that house where love prevails.
Yes,
they are. Keep that door open.
Yes, they are.
And love's going to bring them into the kingdom of God.
Yes.
You believe that?
Yes, that's
right. I believe that with my whole
heart. That's right.
When that girl got up that night, Narwhal, she got up and she walked over to her dad and she said, I've got a lot of things to say, tell you. And boy, it was dramatic. You know, I was just choking up.
Yeah.
He walked over to her and put his hand gently on her mouth and he was sobbing so hard. He said, you don't have to tell me anything. I'm the one that has to tell you, forgive me. And God healed that situation.
Oh, yeah,
that child is free, set free by the power of God. Those demons came out of her that night screaming, set free by the power of God. Last thing he said to me, she is real weak. Her body was diseased with venereal disease. And so picked her up and carried her out. And he turned around and looked at me and he said, just think, Brother Thompson, God's given me back my daughter. Today she's serving the Lord and free. Our God can do anything.
Yeah.
Praise God. Yeah. Our God can do anything.
Zona's supposed to be watching now.
Hi, Zona. Well, yeah. I wish she was here with us tonight.
Yeah. Oh, I know. Sometimes she comes out here. We'll call you.
We'll
get her on.
We'd love it.
Okay.
The Hawaiians are ready to sing for us a wonderful song. What an appropriate song. It's just called Unfailing Love. Please give them a hand, will you?
His heart.
You know you can feel the presence of God. You sense it tonight. It's so strong. A girl called in that's been set free from drugs tonight. Another one said, I've been delivered from marijuana tonight. Another one, I've been on drugs and I've been set free tonight by the power of God. Bernard called in just now, Lake Monroe, Florida, and said, I've given my life to Jesus, and I prayed that prayer with Dwight Thompson. Another one said, Gladys in Tucson, Arizona, I've been set free by the power of God tonight, and I've accepted Jesus as my Savior. Frank in Everett, Washington, said, I've been set free. I've been born again tonight, prayed the sinner's prayer. Nora in Long Beach is 62. She's come to the Lord tonight. Here is Thelma and Ursula 9, all 12. What is this? Am I reading it right? All
three people, three different people.
Three people have been saved, all from the same house, and have all been saved tonight. Praise God. Andy in Fairfax, Virginia has come to the Lord. Dory, you know what I want to talk about in a minute? You made a statement a while ago that a lot of folks may not understand that. A lot of people may not. When you said you went through the house binding the power of the devil. Let's talk about that in a minute.
Okay.
I feel led of the Lord to move into that area so people can learn a little bit more about that.
All right.
Dory in Orange has come to Jesus tonight. Travis in Midland, Texas. Hello, Midland. Has come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Linda in Ocala, Florida. Hello, Florida, and welcome. God bless you. Crystal in Portland, Oregon has come to Jesus. Elva in Huntington Beach has come to the Lord. Jason in Hesperia, California has come to the Lord. Desiree in Long Beach, California has come to Jesus tonight. Amen.
Yes. Ocala. Ocala, Florida, that's close to my work down in Crystal River, Florida.
Yeah.
I have a work in Crystal River, Florida.
Northern central area, isn't
it? I need to get you to come down and preach there. Yeah. They like you there.
Do they?
Yeah, boy.
You'll be there.
Yeah. Me and Benny Hinn's going to preach our Thanksgiving week, all week.
Good.
Benny's got a good ministry.
Yeah, I'll be at Carl Strader's there.
Lakeland.
Oh, yeah, I spoke for him.
Carpenter's home. This will be my 14th consecutive year there.
Isn't that wonderful?
Let's talk about...
I want to ask something before you get into that. Norval, say, you know, if you hadn't known the word like you knew then, say there's a parent out there, maybe just one parent is standing, but they look at the circumstance and they get so discouraged and they really don't know the word. And how can you encourage them to keep holding on for that child when they feel like, you know, well, it's never going to do any good?
Yeah, and all the circumstances go totally against. I was thinking about how many times the devil must have said to you, I'm going to kill her.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, he told me several times, I'm going to kill her.
I'm going to kill her. I'll kill her tonight when she's out there. I've had so many people say that letters.
But you knew how to just not look at the circumstance and keep looking at the word. The word says this, you know, and you stood on that. But a lot of people don't know that.
I know it. See, Jesus said, submit yourself. The Lord said in the book of James, submit yourself, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. And the Bible says the devil's here for three reasons, to kill, steal, and to destroy. When he'd tell me, I'm going to kill your daughter. Mm-hmm. I'm going to kill your daughter. I'm going to destroy your family, kill your daughter, and then I'm going to kill you. I said, no, you're not going to kill my daughter. You're not going to kill me. You're not going to do anything. I bind you, spirit of death, in Jesus' name. You take your hand off of my daughter. Mm-hmm. You're not going to destroy my daughter in Jesus' name. Well, see the Bible says in Matthew chapter 16, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Mm-hmm. Whatever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Jesus said that. And if you'll bind up the power... See, the devil don't really have any power to speak of if you don't cooperate with him. Mm-hmm. As long as you resist him, he is toothless and powerless. Right. He can never get a hold of you. As long as you resist him, in Jesus' name. Mm-hmm. Well, the devil has power at it and can show his power to destroy half of the human race, over half of the human race, is he does it when you yield yourself to him. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then he suggests something to you. Say, I don't believe nothing he tells me. Mm-hmm. If he tells me he's going to kill my daughter, I'm going to say, no, you're not. I resist that in Jesus' name. No, you're not going to. I bind you in Jesus' name. Now, after this happened to me, I made a tape series entitled, How to Deal with Satan and Demons. They could write up my office and get it. And then Zona, after she got a smile on her face again, began to serve the Lord. I wrote a book entitled "Jesus Stand in the Gap for Your Children," mm-hmm. And I put Zona. She was standing right beside of me on the cover, and she puts her head over on my shoulder, and she just holds on to me. And she tells me now, she says, "Daddy, sometimes she'll just walk up to me. Even now, she'll walk up to me and put her head over on my shoulder, and just reach up and kiss me on my cheek, and she'll just start sobbing." Mm-hmm. And I say, "Honey, what are you crying about?" She says, "Well, sometimes, Daddy, you know, I love you so much, Daddy. I love you so much because you rescued me, Daddy." Mm-hmm. She says, "Daddy, had not been for you, I'd be dead. Had not been for your faith mm-hmm. in God, I'd be dead. Mm-hmm. Daddy, I look at you sometimes and I say to myself, he is the reason that I'm living. Wasn't for my daddy, I'd be dead. I wouldn't even be living." She said, "Because you stood in the gap for me." And I did stand the gap for her.
And you didn't give up. What if you'd given
give up?
There wouldn't be anybody praying for her.
Oh, now listen. Let me get, so the parents get it real clear, Zonell. Honey, if I'd have given up, she'd be dead.
Right. So
there's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. Mm-hmm. She'd be dead. You couldn't reach her.
If they just know one mm-hmm. scripture, just if they don't know that much about the Bible, if they just get a hold of that one scripture in Matthew, whatsoever you bind
That's
on
right.
earth shall be. They can start right there.
Study the 16th chapter of the book of Matthew. Study that chapter. It tells you about the power of the church. And if whatever you bind on earth should be bound in heaven. And then the Lord says, when you give your life to me, I give you a set of keys. I give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven.
Right.
You have a key to every lock. And you unlock the lock. Faith mm-hmm. unlocks the lock. The Word unlocks the lock. See, everything in heaven is in heaven. It's locked up and you can't get it out of heaven except through the name of Jesus and faith. Mm-hmm. Faith in the name of Jesus. You can get anything from heaven to come down to you. But things in heaven, they don't come down to earth cheap. And the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit's here. Yeah, but he lives inside of you, but he won't ever do anything for you, the Holy Spirit won't, unless you obey the Word. Because, mm-hmm. see, he's only here to perform the Word. That's all he's here for. He's not here to perform a bunch of religion and a bunch of goofy stuff and going around doing everything for you. He won't do anything for you. Mm-hmm. There's one thing the Holy Spirit will let you do, though. He'll let you die. He won't do anything for you. He won't heal you. He won't set you free. He lives inside of you. Paul said, stir up the gift that's in you. The gift of the Holy Spirit. Now, if you'll obey the Bible, the New Testament, and obey what the Lord Jesus Christ says, and stir up and rise up and say, I bind you devils that's trying to keep my children away from God. I bind you and I command you turn my children loose. You'll never take my children to hell. I stand the gap for them in Jesus' name. And every day you call your child free from the devil.
Amen.
Call your child free. Now when you start doing that, then the Holy Spirit approves of what you're doing and he'll start working. But the Holy Spirit, the Bible tells you the Holy Spirit, Dwight, is a performer. He performs the Word of God. Any part of the Word of God that you believe in the New Testament, he will perform it for you now. You can bind the weakest person out there. If they make up their mind, they can cast out devils. They can say, in Jesus' name, you devil, go from me. Either cast out devils or make the devil leave you. It's all some, you know, boy, the bottom line is make the devil leave you. All you have to do is make the devil leave you. Say, in Jesus' name, go from me. It's called and resist the devil. The first thing that God wants a human being to do is bow down before him and worship his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. See, submit yourself, therefore, to God. And then the second thing the Lord wants you to do is don't be ignorant all your life and let the enemy of God destroy
right.
you.
Right. Mm-hmm.
He said, submit yourself, therefore, to God. And then resist the devil and he will flee from you. Mm-hmm. Now, in my case, it was dope devils that's trying to kill my mm-hmm. child. Mm-hmm. Now, there's people out there listening, Dwight, that's got cancer. Mm-hmm. And they're going to die. That's got some disease. The doctor says there's no hope for them. They need to use exactly the same way, speak with the same authority, use the same name, Jesus' name, and call it like it is, cancer, in Jesus' name, I resist you.
Yeah.
I bind you. You're not going to kill me. I resist you and I command you, you go from me.
Mm-hmm.
Now the person that's got it must do that.
Yeah.
not try to find 14,000 preachers to pray for you and you not do anything. No. No, obey Jesus before you do men. Submit yourself therefore to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. And if they will, I'm telling you, the disease will disappear, start disappearing. If the child is on dope, if they'll do that, Dwight, the devils will start, they don't want to, but the devils will start turning them loose. They have to turn them loose. They have to turn their minds loose, their minds loose. And that, and if you'll show love to that child, then that child's mind will begin to get hungry for reality and hungry for the love of God. Hungry. You know how it is when you start getting hungry for Jesus. He shows up. Be free. You can bind up devils in Jesus' name. Anybody can. And it's hard to teach somebody just in a little while, Dwight, but if they come to teach us, that's to come to your services or come to some of my seminars. Or a good place to come sometime is come to my Bible school. I have a Bible college for 10 years where we have 3 classes every morning, 5 mornings a week. And if the parents could come there every year for a week, I teach on that. All week long I teach on it. Well, if they come and sit in on that, then they could learn how to do it. Or they could get my tape series, or they could get that little book, How Stand in the Gap for Your Children. They need to study something, study the Word of God, so they can do it themselves. If they'd rise up and say, in Jesus' name I bind you, Satan, take your hand off of my child, and thank God for their child being victory and pray continually, he would do that. But see, if the parent don't do it, see, if you're not trying to do that, though, if you're not trying to do that, Dwight, you wind up not doing it. You know what I mean?
The devil run all over you.
Yeah, you wind up, and you don't do it continually. You have to do it continually. And the devil just runs roughshod over you all the time. All the time. When we're born again like we are, Dwight, and people out there are born again with the Spirit of God living inside of you, you don't supposed to be taking things off of the devil. Now that's ignorance gone to seed. You don't supposed to be letting the devil push you around in no respect.
It's really the other way around is what
that's
it's supposed
right.
to be.
If you submit yourself to God and resist the devil, it'll be just like the Lord said. He will start fleeing from you.
I think a lot of people really don't realize that we haven't been left here to be defeated by the devil.
That's right.
We've been left here to defeat
Amen.
The devil.
That's right.
Because he's given us the power to
Amen.
Do it.
Amen.
Yes, that Jesus said, I'll put him under the soles of your feet.
A lot of people have that confused.
Yeah.
There's a lot of ways to defeat the devil. If you want to jot a couple of things down, I kind of feel led of the Lord. Let's talk about these.
Yes.
First one, the first way I... One of the ways you can defeat the devil, Narvel's talked about, is through the name of Jesus.
Amen.
The name of Jesus. I always remember that in every instance, whether it was in this country or many of the overseas meetings, when you would go to pray for people that were possessed of devils, the one word that would incite the greatest wrath from those devils and demons would be the name of Jesus.
That's right.
The most violent reaction that you would ever witness that would surface would be the name of Jesus.
Yes, sir.
When this girl I was talking about a moment ago, I begin to say in the name of Jesus. And every time you'd begin to say in the name of Jesus, this child, I don't have the proper word to describe it, but it would be like a convulsion, or it would be like jerking, uncontrollably distraught, and these demons and devils inside her would scream.
Oh, sure.
Would scream out.
They will.
But it would always be at the name of Jesus. Now the word says that God hath highly exalted him and given him a name that is above every name.
Amen.
That at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow. Now everybody, for instance, right now in this studio audience and at home, say Jesus.
Jesus.
Say that out loud again. Jesus.
Jesus.
Now Jesus is a name. Satan is a name. Would you agree to that?
Yes.
Satan is a name.
Yes.
Cancer is a name.
Yes.
Demons and devils is a name. Drug addiction is a name or a title. Well, the Bible said that at the name of Jesus, every knee is going to bow. Jesus is not intimidated, nor is not stricken with fear at the name of cancer.
That's right.
Nor drug addiction, nor devils,
It's quite the contrary.
That's right, Dwight.
It's the devils and the demons and the cancer. The Word says, has to bow the knee to the name of Jesus. The reason that Satan is so terrified of the name of Jesus, you remember when he got through with Satan in Matthew 4 with three verses out of the book of Deuteronomy, it is written, when he was through with Satan there, the Bible said that Satan left him. Do you realize that when Jesus Christ died on the cross of Calvary, to all of those it seemed apparent on the surface that this was the greatest blow and the greatest defeat and probably the complete extermination of this Christian Jesus character, this religious fanatical zealot and all of his followers, and when they got through with Christ, this whole thing called Christianity would be done away with once and for all. Well, what Satan didn't realize and what those watching around that cross didn't realize when he finally proclaimed and said, "It is finished," that wasn't the end. That was the beginning. Because in the next 3 days and three nights in the belly of hell, Jesus Christ walked into the very throne room. He walked into hell's headquarters. He stripped Satan of his power. He took away his authority. In death, he was more powerful even than he was, it seems, in life. Now Satan had to deal with him as a spirit. When he came out of the pit of hell on the third day, there was no Roman decree that could hold him, no soldier, no stone. Not all of the powers and the forces of hell could keep him incarcerated in the belly of hell. On the third day, life came into that body. Jesus came forth and declared, "I am He that was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. I have the keys of death." I say it again, death is intimidated by the name of Jesus. Jesus is not intimidated by the name death. He said, "I have the keys of death. I have the keys of hell. I have the keys of the last enemy, which is the grave." When he came out of the pit of hell, he once and proclaimed, "I'm the new champion, not Satan." But then what he did, he said to all of us that remain, "Now when I go away, I'm going to leave you, I'm going to leave you the power of attorney. I'm giving you the power of attorney. I'm giving you the power of authority. I'm giving you the right to use my name." That's why he said, then when you come against demons and devils, don't come against them in your power. You don't have any in yourself.
That's right.
In fact, they came up to him and they said, the demon said to those seven sons, that "Paul I know and Jesus I know, but who are you?" It doesn't do any good to say, "I come against you in the name of Narvel Hayes."
That's right.
"I'm coming against you, Satan, in the name of Jimmy Swaggart or Ken Copeland or Billy Graham." That's not going to work. He's not impressed.
No.
He said, "You come against him in the name of Jesus."
Jesus.
Well, the very moment you say the name of Jesus, the reason that that has power that delivers and makes Satan flee is because Satan remembers what Jesus did to him. Jesus completely destroyed his power and his authority. And when Satan comes against you, you look at him and stand your ground and say, "Satan, I come against you in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God." And you know what? He has to flee. Satan has to flee. The next way you come against him is through the Word of the living God. That Word, Mark 13:31 says, "Heaven and earth will pass away, but my Word will not pass away." Isaiah 54:17, "No weapon formed against you shall prosper." You know, Narvel, when you were talking about that a while ago, really what Satan was trying to do, he works through several ways. He works through torment. He works in the minds where he works.
Yes, yes,
you know, the war is in the mind.
Yeah.
Someone has said that fear, if you let it, will open the door of defeat to your heart.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what Satan did was, when he told you he's going to kill your daughter, now, he was stating his position of his intention.
Oh, sure he was.
You could have given into that.
Mm-hmm.
You did. And when you said a while ago, you were the one standing
That's
between
right.
that demon force and Satan. I remember Jan Crouch telling a story one time that's very powerful. When the enemy was trying to kill her, literally trying to kill her, her father is with the Lord now, but a powerful, powerful Pentecostal, spirit-filled man of God, Dad Edgar Bethany. And one night, tells that story of how Satan came in and said, "I'm going to kill your daughter." And Brother Bethany said, "No, you're not." A lot of people think I'm helpless in those situations with my children. That's not the case. What you're doing right now won't save them. They can't get saved except when they receive Christ as their Savior. But if you were to come right now and try to jump on Narvel Hayes, I could help him a little bit. Mm-hmm. You know, I can't make you get saved, but I can help fight back those forces that come against you that really leave you paralyzed, at least to where you could make a decision mm-hmm. for Jesus Christ. That's why prayer is a powerful force.
Yeah. You know, well, yes, it is.
Brother Bethany stood power of the Word of God and literally saw that demon force take form and wrestled with him.
Oh, yeah.
Literally fought him and defeated him in the name of Jesus and put his foot on that devil's neck, if you will. Wrestled him. And when that thing left, it left. Mm-hmm. Said, "You're not getting my daughter."
Yeah,
I mean,
right.
You may get other people's daughters, but you're not getting mine. That's the way Dad bet. And that's the way it is with you and I. When we stand, but don't let... I want to talk about fear a minute, Narvel.
Yes.
The devil could have said, and probably did, he could have said, "Yeah, your child's not going to be saved." Said, "Look how she's living."
Oh, yeah.
You know.
That's right.
Where's that wonderful, it's not the way it's quoted, but its implications the same, that your children are disciples taught of the Lord in obedience to the will of God. And great shall be their peace and composure.
Undisturbed
peace and composure. And this one woman was telling me when she was standing in the gap for her child, her daughter. And similarly, what you were saying, she said, "I had to put my child to bed." Mm-hmm. My husband and I, she said, we would put her to bed. And she would be incoherent. She wouldn't even know her name. Mm-hmm. She'd think she's an animal and bark. And look at you and just be off out in some kind of twilight zone, just floating around. We'd put her to bed and the devil would say, that was their scripture. They'd see her coming. They'd say, "Here comes my child and she's a disciple, taught of the Lord and in obedience to the will of God. Oh, thank God. Great shall be her peace. Lord, I thank you. Here comes..." And she'd be walking in, you'd say hi, and she'd go, "Hey," you know, just floated off out in the... And the devil would say, "Yeah, there goes your disciple." Well, the devil would mock them.
Oh, yeah,
then they'd
put
her to bed sometimes so stoned, she wouldn't even know who she was or where she was. And the devil would haunt them. Say, "You're a liar. Your child's not a disciple taught of the Lord." Well, look at her.
Yeah.
She's a Flake City kid. I mean, she is out of it.
Yeah.
"I'm going to kill her." But you know what they said? We kept coming back to the Word. Mm-hmm. And we kept standing on the Word of God. And ladies and gentlemen, there comes a time when everything that you draw from in the natural, with you seeing with your natural eye, whatever it is that you can squeeze out that encourages you, when that's gone, and every circumstance is against you, every mountain it seems like has loomed larger than ever, and you don't know what to do, and there's no one around, all you're to do then is to stand on the Word of God.
That's right.
And don't let Satan stampede you into fear and even sudden fear. Proverbs 3:25-26 says, "Be not afraid of sudden fear, neither of the desolation of the wicked when it cometh. For the Lord shall be thy confidence, and he shall keep thy foot from being taken." Deuteronomy 33:27, "The eternal God is thy refuge. Underneath are the everlasting arms, and he, God, shall thrust out the enemy from before thee. And he shall destroy them." Isaiah 43:2, "When you pass through the waters, I will be with thee. Through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and neither shall the flame kindle against thee."
Isaiah 41 verse 10 says, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness." There comes a time when everything else around you has just come crashing down. The devil says he's going to kill him. You just stand on the Word of God and fear not.
That's right.
You know why? You don't have to go to God and tell Him how big that devil is. You don't have to go to God and tell Him how big your mountain is. You got it backwards. You go to that devil and you tell him how big your God is.
Yes.
And you go to that mountain and you say, "Mountain, I just want to tell you how big my God is." Yes. You hear what I'm saying? Yes. You're not intimidated by the mountain, nor the circumstance. Every time the devil tried to say to you, "I'm going to kill that daughter," you just stood on there and said, "No, no, you're not."
Yes, sir. Well, now that word you said right then, if the world, the human race could ever understand that, that word you said right then is the, it's a little bitty word, everybody knows it, is the greatest word you ever said to the devil. When the devil tells you, when he brings temptation to you for you to do something, or if he tells you you're going to kill your daughter on dope, like he did me, or you, "I'm going to do this," you rise up, the greatest word you ever say to him is say, "No."
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Two little letters.
Yeah.
No. When you say no to the devil, he goes,
yeah. Power of a positive no.
Now, if you don't say no to him, he keeps on moving in, trying to bombard your mind, But when you say no, I mean with authority.
Yeah.
And if he doesn't say no, in Jesus' name, no.
He can't do it.
Look at this right here.
Yeah.
Isn't that wonderful?
Read it for me. We'll just
delivered say. From drugs tonight by testimony by Norval Hayes.
Hallelujah.
Believing that he is free from drugs from Los Angeles, California.
All right. Well, it said, "Thank the Lord for Norval tonight. He's blessed me. I renewed my vows to God." This is from Georgia and Tampa City. Here is to Norval. She feels her burden lifted. She has received her answer from God tonight. Mm-hmm. Here is said, "I've been healed from brain scars due to drug abuse."
Praise God.
Oh,
praise God.
Thank God.
Another one said, Norval Hayes, said she loves Jesus. She's been delivered from drugs last night. Well, thank God for that. Prayers were answered for this mother about her son, and she's been set free, and all kinds of trouble and all this, but the Lord's working a miracle. Patrick, 18-year-old, has accepted the Lord and has been delivered from drugs. Let's praise God for it, everybody.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
You know, another thing that is so wonderful to think about when you are in this situation is to know that God loves them more than you love them.
Yes, He is.
Isn't that neat?
Oh, that's wonderful.
Sometimes you got to just turn them over to God.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and
you
just,
sure do.
Just go to sleep. Say, "God, I know you love them more than I love them." But I feel also tonight that this program has really been directed to a wife that's standing for her husband.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
And maybe you already had the divorce papers. Don't let it rattle you. You just stand on the Word. God is working on him right now. Yeah. And God loves that man more than you do.
Yeah. Turn him over to God.
Yeah, a lot of people don't realize this, Sonel, but faith in God basically works the same way for everything.
Mm-hmm. Right.
When defeat begins to come across your path for you or your children or whatever, if you begin to show faith in God, that unwavering faith in God with a voice of authority brings victory in every case.
Hallelujah.
It does. Mm-hmm. But the devil listens to authority. The devil never listens to weak people. Are people that don't pray or say no to him. He never listens to weak people, but he only listens to strength.
You know, Norval, the greatest example we have in the life of our Lord, how he dealt with the devil, was in Matthew 4.
Mm-hmm.
When Jesus had fasted for 40 days and 40 nights, his body and condition was weakened. He was at the most vulnerable state physically, mentally, and probably spiritually that you could ever be. Now, Jesus' example of how he combated and won victory over the power of Satan is illustrated in Matthew 4.
Mm-hmm.
And he simply did three things. Each time Satan came to tempt him, Jesus used the infallible word of the living God. And that's the point I want to make. Yeah. And if Jesus can defeat Satan with three verses out of the book of Deuteronomy, surely we can defeat him with all the promises of God that are at our disposal.
That's right. And every time in that scripture, every time when Satan came to him, Jesus would say, if you notice there, he would say, It is written.
Hallelujah.
I'm standing on that.
That last time he said, it is written, I shall serve the Lord thy God. I shall worship the Lord, and him only shall I serve. Go from me, Satan. And the Bible says that Satan turned around and left him, and then the angels came and began to minister to Jesus.
Glory. Hallelujah. You're going to have a lot of those big angels in your house.
God, he said, I'm sure there's more than one angel there, but he let one just walk in. Yeah. Minister to my daughter. She's living tonight with a husband and a cute little girl, happy, loves the Lord, because God sees fit to send an angel into her room.
Has she seen that angel since?
No, but she's expecting to.
Yeah.
She said, yeah, she's expecting to. The thing of it is, when you're as big as two men and you just come from out of the presence of God, you don't have to preach no sermons.
No, that's right.
You don't have to sing no songs.
That's right.
You don't have to say no prayers. You just have to show up in front of sin. And when you come from the presence of God, big as two men, and sin begins to get nervous.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
The devils begin to get nervous all over, you know, and you just show up.
Yeah. It's kind of discouraging. You're the devil.
Yeah.
When they sick that big angel on them, it's kind of tough.
Because, see, that angel knows something about the natural world and the spirit world both.
Yeah.
See, he knows both sides of the world.
He knows it better than anybody.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. Because
he's here to minister to the natural people, but he come from the presence of God in the spirit world.
Well, we're having a great night tonight, and in just a few minutes, we're going to have Charlie Osborne. I didn't realize the time had gotten to where it is right now. But we're going to have him join us up here. I want you to stay up here with us. Will you do that?
Yes, I will.
God's not through with you.
Yeah, he's got a good story. Charlie Osborne got a good story to tell, too, that fits right in with this.
Good.
Yeah.
Precious.
Oh, it's a great night. Let's just praise God before we go any further for what he is doing. Lots of calls. You know, just before I forget this, we've had a ton of calls saying, Dwight, when is the next meeting in Southern California area? I don't have the date in front of me. I know it's in January. We'll be back at the convention center, and we're expecting thousands of people at that thing. So I'll be talking more about it. So kind of keep that... we're going to see a move of God in this old Southern California area.
Mm-hmm.
I remember, never forget, 4 years ago, whatever it was, that meeting broke out at Meldyland Christian Center. I'll never forget that. A couple of nights, and I think we went on off and on for about 2 years. And tens of thousands came to the Lord in that thing. And I've felt in my spirit something. It's not anything you have written out yet, and you don't have all the instructions, but I feel in my spirit something's about to break loose.
Yeah.
In this great Southern California area.
This is a good area.
We're going to be a part of it. Mm-hmm. We're going to see it. It's happening across the land.
Yes.
God's moving in great power. You're going to have a tremendous conference coming up December 1 through 6.
Yeah.
In Palm Springs, California at the
Embassy Suites.
Embassy Suites there. You and Brother Schambach are going to be preaching that thing.
Yeah, me and Schambach will be together all week.
December 1 through 6.
December 1 through 6, Embassy Suites.
Embassy Suites.
They can make reservations, stay there. That's the headquarters motel. We have a special rate for them. Right. They stay at the Embassy Suites. And the meetings will be right there in their ballroom.
Morning and evening.
And three meetings a day.
Good.
10, 2, and 7:30 at night.
You guys are preaching them.
Yeah.
It's going to be
Schambach and me.
Dynamic duel.
Yeah, amen.
It's going to be something else.
Yeah.
Don't forget that. It's going to be a great time. Let's give the Hawaiians a big hand. In a few moments, we're going to be introducing Brother Charles Osborne. Charlie Osborne, and I want to talk to this man. He's a fired up Catholic's what he is.
Oh, yeah. Catholic evangelist.
Yeah, Catholic. I've never heard of a Catholic evangelist. I didn't know they have. I asked him about that earlier. He said they do now.
Yeah. That's right.
Give the Hawaiians a big hand. Will you do that?
above his name there is no other name. The one who is eternally the same, there is no other name. The first and last, beginning and the end, he was the king who made the common man his friend. There is no other name. Let every tongue proclaim and sing the name of Jesus. Magnify and praise the name of Jesus. No other name but Jesus. His power is the precious name of Jesus.
He created all that is within his hands, and yet the smallest need he understands. There is no other name. The one who said, I am.
Without any further ado, let's welcome Charles Osborne. Will you do it? Welcome. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
We'll dispense with a lot of things that we usually do when I bring a guest up like this, but I want to just jump on into something because you're right where we are tonight. He said to me, let's just keep flowing. I feel something from the Lord. Charles Osborne was a very, very, very successful businessman. He was
doing some tremendous things in the business world. But it's a man that he himself was involved in the drug scene. 5 children involved in the drug scene. Now, he knows what he's talking about, and he knew what we were talking about while we were talking about this tonight, because he's experienced it. And, well, let's get into it. Charles, I'm so glad to have you here.
Well, it's, you can't...
Spirit-filled Catholic, is that what you call yourself?
Well,
I just call you spirit-filled Christian or whatever.
I'm Roman Catholic, and I'm an evangelist in the Roman Catholic Church, preaching the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. Yeah. Norval said a very important thing in the prophecy that came to him in the car, that he was to tell his daughter that he loved him. See, all of my life, for the people that are watching and for you people here, I never knew how to love anybody. I didn't know what love was. My love was in a conditional. It was a Eros love. I loved people like I loved hamburger. If they got too greasy, I'd throw them away. And I treated, you know, that's basically the way most people love today. It's a hamburger relationship. You know, you go from one hamburger joint to the next. Mm-hmm. And that's an Eros love. And that love is never mentioned in Scripture. Mm-hmm. It's agape love and filial love. Agape love is the willingness to suffer without retaliation. And this brother suffered.
Yeah.
He suffered his daughter, and he never retaliated. See, what we've done, we've made a... when I'm here, I'm preaching already, but let me...
That's what I want you to do. I'll get you a pulpit if you want
well,
to.
No, but let me go back to, to the beginning of how I got into this.
If you need us, you just holler.
We're going to amen you.
My parish priest, Father Jim Smith, came to my restaurant one day and made a startling statement to me. He said, Charlie, you need to give your life to Jesus. And I thought it was the strangest thing I'd ever heard. I knew Jesus. I knew all about him. I knew about the Holy Spirit. I knew about God. But I never knew that there was any way I could give myself to him. It was, you know, it was as Catholic, we understand miracles, and we know that God is God, and we know that Jesus Christ is the Lord, and we know the Holy Spirit is the Lord and giver of life, but we've never brought it into a personal relationship, a personal experience. So my parish priest brought this in to a relationship to me, and one day he said something to me that really, it really overwhelmed me. He said, Charlie, I was having a difficult time with my kids and my wife, because once I experienced Jesus, you know, here come the whip. You know, you kids are going to get in line.
Yeah.
I mean, you're going to stop this foolishness. Now, I'd raised them for 19 years to be arrogant, boastful, conceited, independent, self-righteous. I mean, just a little...
Yeah, and those were your good points.
Yeah, you know, the little rebellious, just total rebellion. And,
I'm sorry.
That's okay, brother.
I may never have that chance again.
And Father Smith asked me, he said, would you go home and get down on your knees and let your kids beat you up? Just whip you like you like you've done all of your life. You've whipped them, you've tongue beat them, you've oppressed them. Would you go home and get out on your knees and just let them beat you up? And you know, Orville, and I've had to think about that. I said, you know, I don't think I'd do that. And Father Smith said, the day that you can go get on your knees and let one of them beat you up is the day you'll understand the love of Jesus Christ for you. He took a whipping for you, buddy. Yeah. He went to the cross. He was scourged. He was spat on. He was beaten. He was thorned, and he was crucified for you.
Yeah.
And he said, the day that you can look up to your kids instead of down, the day that you can become a servant to your children and your wife, the day that you can look at them and love them unconditionally the way Jesus has loved you, that's the day you'll experience the love of Jesus Christ. And I made up my mind. I went home and got down on my knees to my 19-year-old son. That's, we call him Little Ox. I mean, you know, he's just a, he's quite a man. And you know, and I knew the day was coming that probably we'd get in some kind of a tuffle, but I never knew it'd be like this. So I got down on my knees, and I'd never been able to tell my son that I loved him. Now, my son was on drugs. My daughter, Regina Norville, that came to see you over at Liberty Bible College, yeah, she was on drugs. Craig, my son, was on drugs. Douglas, and my little 12-year-old had experienced drugs. Mm. And I was the main cause of it because I was the ringleader. I was the head of the house. I was going through all this. I got down on my knees and I asked my son, I said, "Son, I give you the right to do whatever to me you want to do. You want to whip me, you want to kick me, you want to curse me, whatever you feel like doing."
Now, was he the strong one?
The big one.
Yeah.
And I says, "You have the right. I won't retaliate. I'll let you do to me whatever you want to do." And that day, my son looked at me. He said, "Daddy, I don't want to beat you up. I love you." And it was the first time, Norville, in 19 years that my son and I had ever looked at one another and said we loved one another. God. See, the problem that we have in the world today is there's no love. Mm-hmm. In 1 Corinthians 13:4, it says, "Love is patient, love is kind, love is never jealous, rude, nor selfish. Love never takes offense." I was always offended by my family. I was offended by my wife. I was offended by what the kids did, and I was always reacting instead of acting. Yeah. Yeah. And when I begin to act in love, when Norval talked about the coconut pie,
yeah,
when I begin to serve my children, not serving them, demanding something in return. See, I used to threaten them with money. "I'll give you money if you do what I want, and if you don't do what I won't give you no money." Coercion,
yeah.
Fear. You know, they was always fearful of me. They never know what I was going to do next. Or I'd give them something and then beat them because they didn't use it right. Yeah. Now, I know that, you know, there's some people listening that's going through this thing right now. We wouldn't be talking about it.
Yeah. Yeah.
There's families right now that's getting set Same free mm-hmm. because the day that you can look at that unique, an original masterpiece of God, and the child is only one of its kind in all of the world, all the people it's ever been or ever will be, that child, the children, the husband, the wife, there's only one. And when we can begin to look up to one another mm-hmm. with admiration and love and respect and with a servant attitude, I begin to serve my family. Now, I'm not going to tell you that my kids came out of it like that. Mm-hmm. I've worked on it for years. Mm-hmm. And some of the families need to know this. 3 years ago, when this magazine, when it came out in 2 years ago in September 1984, I walked in. I had a dream. I came home. Norval, you know about dreams, and I'm sure you do, Dwight. You God speaks to you in a dream. Mm-hmm. I'd flown home from San Francisco had a big camp meeting out there in a Roman Catholic church. Got a lot of people saved, baptized.
You mean the Catholics have camp meetings?
Oh, yeah. Right in the sanctuary. you guys have done a number on us.
We better get with it, I'll tell you.
But, I flew home and I had this this vision or this dream. And I was, two men came up to me and put me in jail in this dream, and I said, you know, what am I doing in jail? I've not done anything to get in jail. And I didn't get an answer. And after a while, I said, what have I got to do to get out? And this voice said, fast and pray. And I said, how long? And the answer that came back was 14 days. And I said, I can't do that. I mean, you look at me and tell, I can't. There's no way I can go 14 days without food. That's crazy. And I said, Lord, I can't go 14 days without food. He said, then stay in jail. And I woke up, and I thought, my goodness, I better at least try, because I know that God's speaking to me. On the fourth day of my fast, I walked in her office. And you know about fasting. I didn't. I never had been on a fast. And the fourth day in the fast, I was hurting. Man, I'm going to tell you, my stomach would have eaten anything. I mean, my mouth would have just, you know.
Yeah.
I walked into my office weak and kind of pale. And my oldest son, with hair down to his back, had, his mama had just begged him to come work for us in our office because the ministry was growing. And he's driving a taxi, you know, just total rebellious. Mm-hmm. And so he was a good typist and a writer and all these kind of things, but he'd never worked with us. Just wouldn't have. This is just 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. Now this is 8 years. Mm-hmm. 8 years I've walked and served. Patient, obedient, kind, serving, edifying, strengthening, and loving, mm-hmm. giving. And I walked in the office, and I only stayed a few minutes. I just had to go right back home and go to bed because I was so weak. Mm-hmm. I couldn't maneuver. And my son asked my wife, said, "What's wrong with Dad?" And my wife said, "Well, we're not supposed to tell anybody about fasting, but If you won't say anything, he's fasting." And Brian said, "You mean the old man's not eating? That guy's never been without food. How long has he been without food?" My wife said, 4 days. He said, 4 days. And he said, "How long is he going to fast?" And my wife said, 14 days. He said, "He can't do it." My wife says, "I know it. He knows it, and you know it. But he's God's called him to it, and he's going to go as long as he can." An hour later, my son got up out of his seat and excused himself and was gone a couple hours and came back. His hair was as short as mine, shaved off his beard, and he walked in the door and he said, "This day I've given my life to the Lord Jesus."
Praise God.
8 years of waiting. 8 years of praying. I've been woken up in the middle of the night, Dwight. I mean, in a lurch. And the Holy Spirit would say to me, "Pray for your kids. Pray for..." he'd single one out. "Pray for him. Pray for him." And I'd get on my knees and I'd begin to pray. And I'd pray for a while and get back into bed. He said, "I said pray." Back down on the... And I've done that all night. See, when you understand the spirituality of the warfare that goes on and Satan is trying to steal, and Norval has said it time and time again, he can't steal if there's someone that can stand in the gap. My wife and I have stood in the gap for our 5 kids for 10 years. Now, they've come in. It's been a slow, gradual process because I'd raised them so hard in the world. And I know tonight they're watching my daughter Regina that is just loves Norval. She had taken her boyfriend. This is 8 years ago, 9 years ago. Norval was at Liberty Bible College in Pensacola, and my daughter had seen that I had just miraculously changed it. I'd begin to treat them like they were people, and really started loving them and wasn't coercing them or causing fear. And she said, "Boy, I'd like for my boyfriend to be like Daddy now." And she took him to Norval's meeting, and they both gave their life to Jesus in Norval's meeting. Great. And Norval has touched millions of people around this country. And I know, Dwight, that you have. See, in the Roman Catholic Church, where I preach 99% of my time, you fellas don't really realize what you've done. You've opened the door for me to get into my own church and preach the gospel. Kenneth Copeland, Kenneth Hagin, Oral Roberts, all of these men that have persisted and stood and proclaimed the gospel and encouraged and just almost challenged us. Because, see, we've got TVs in our home, and we watch. But I'd never, you know, I wouldn't watch too long because I couldn't stand them, you know, "Hallelujah." I just couldn't take
that.
That'd drive the devil nuts,
Yeah. that's upsetting.
Yeah, but tonight, you know, my family is fully engaged in this ministry.
Yeah.
And it's just wonderful, Dwight, to and I know that there's families... if they can ever learn the love that Jesus had for me was unconditional. Norval said it. He never beat me over the head. He never come down and said, you know, you sorry rascal, I'm just going to give you one more shot at this thing. And if you don't make it, I'm going to dump you.
Yeah.
He stayed for 43 years. He waited on me. And how long would I wait for one of my kids? Dwight, what I found, one of the biggest problems in our families today, in the I've traveled all over the United States for the past 7 years, and the greatest tragedy in this nation today are Christians that are kicking their children out of their homes. This tough love thing. There's no such thing. Jesus never tough loved me. That thing has swept this United States. Love is patient, and it's kind, and it's not offended. It serves. It's a servant. It's willing to die. It becomes a living sacrifice, a willingness. Agape love is a willingness to suffer without retaliation. And we've got to understand that. And we've just opened up our first home for abused kids in Tallahassee, Florida. And we've had it open a month. It's already full of girls that have been thrown away, just kicked out by their parents, no place to live, on drugs. They come home pregnant, out, no place to go. I mean, that's the time that you love. That's the time that you... that requires grace. See, if you love those that love you, what grace is there in that? Sinners love those that love them. But we're called to love unconditional. Our love is committed to a strength and a power that overcomes evil. And it's just exciting, brother. And I know there's people watching right now that are making a decision to begin to speak to their kids, love. I love you. You know, that was the hardest thing in the world for me to say. I love you. You're wonderful. You're precious.
Yeah. You'd be surprised how many people, how many teenagers come up to me, how many letters I get.
Yeah.
20 years old. My parents have never said
Never.
My dad's never put his arm around
me. Yeah, that's right.
I got a, all the time. There's a family that lives in Toledo, Adam and his wife, that has a home for abused kids. And every time I go to Ohio for the past 3 years, they bring these kids to me, and I've watched them grow. I've watched, you know, and the kids had everything wrong with them. They're, you know, sexually abused, incest, I mean, all kinds, drugs, abortion, just everything. And I begin to love these young girls. And I got a letter from one the other day, just before I came out on this particular trip. And she said, Charlie, how can you love me the way you do, and my daddy can't love me? My mommy can't love me the way you love me. How? What allows you to love me the way you do? And the answer that I sent back is because you're an original masterpiece of God, created by the Father, and saved by the Lord Jesus Christ, even though you may not know it. Delivered from sin and death, even though you may not know it. And the good news that I bring to you is that Jesus has paid the price. Jesus has won the battle. The victory's over. The glory of God is ours, if we can just begin to share it. 2 Corinthians 5:16, I think, says, or 20, that God has reconciled all of mankind to himself through the Lord Jesus Christ, no longer holding any faults against any man.
What an overwhelming thing.
Amen.
So now, if he's not holding any faults against me, how can I hold a fault against you? See, that's what will bring the community together, is when we can begin to love one another and forgive one another. And that scripture, it's whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. And it says, whatever you loose on earth is loosed in heaven. Do you know I forgive sin? I forgive my kids their sins. I forgive. And love covers a multitude of sin. Whoever sins you forgive, they're forgiven. Whoever sins you retain, they're retained. And we've just got to learn that in our Christian homes. That I forgive my children their sins. Sin stops with me. As an ambassador to the kingdom, sin, I don't react to sin. I act in love, and it stops right here.
Yeah.
And that heals.
Yeah.
That overcomes evil. That disperses the devil. That beats him because all he can do is hate.
Mm-hmm.
He can't love.
Mm-hmm.
And love overcomes evil.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory
Beautiful.
Be to God forever.
Well, this is tremendous. We're going to pray in a few moments for the needs of the people. We're going to ask Narvel Hayes and Charlie Osborne if they'll just join with us in prayer. I'm going to ask the Hawaiians if they'll sing for us again right now. If you have a prayer request, you have something on your life that you need from God, no matter what it is, we're going to stand with you in faith tonight, believing that God will meet every need. We're going to pray more tonight for your loved ones, for your children, for your marriages, for your wives and husbands. I knew a woman one time that suffered an awful lot of abuse from her husband. He, for many, many years, was an alcoholic, and he really would mistreat her. He would beat her up, but she'd stand in her faith.
Amen.
And stand with that true Christ-like love. And she had, according to the Scripture, she had scriptural reasons maybe to leave that man and divorce him. He had been unfaithful to her repeatedly. But she said, no, she said, if I can win him to God, if I'll stand true and win him to Christ, then others will come to the Lord too. Well, things got better. Things, I should say, got worse long before they got better. And he would beat her up, do terrible things to her. She just kept loving him into the kingdom of God. She had one phrase that she'd always say to him when he would mistreat her. No matter what he'd do, she'd look at him, and you knew it was only God could let her say it, and she'd say, I love you. No matter what you do, I love you. This went on for years. Finally, she got ready one night to go to the Wednesday night prayer meeting. And he's drunk, as he often is. And he was playing with a gun, a revolver, and he said, I just may kill you tonight if you try to go to church. And she just kept getting dressed. When she went through the living room, she was putting on her coat, and he was sitting on the couch, and he said, if you go toward that door, I'll pull this trigger. She got her coat on and her purse around her arm, and she reached out to the doorknob to go out. And he said, if you open that door, I'll blow your brains out. She looked over at him, and she smiled, and she said, Charlie, she said, if you pull that trigger, she said, I'm going to go straight to heaven. But if you don't, I'm going to church. She went out the door that night. She always prayed, and she held on to God for him.
Amen.
And she would always stand in the gap. But the one thing she did was she loved him.
Amen.
With the kind of love that Brother Osborne's talking about tonight. Wasn't long that very night, that a call came early and she went home. And this man had taken all of his booze and turned it upside down in the sink.
That's right.
He was on the floor of the kitchen crying out to the top of his voice, Lord, forgive me.
Amen.
He pulled this dear woman down on the floor with him. He was so overcome with emotion, and he held her face in his hands. His tears, he couldn't hold them back as he brushed her face. And he said, I've hit you many times. I've mistreated you. And he said, if a woman like you can stay with a man like me and love me, I'll serve your God the rest of my life.
Amen.
That's been 20 years. And today that man is still walking with the love of Jesus flowing in his heart because one woman said, I'm going to love him into the kingdom of God. Wives, get ready. God's going to give you a new husband.
Amen.
He'll have the same name, but he'll really have a new name. We're holding on to God. God's going to save that husband or that wife. I believe that with all my heart. The Hawaiians are going to sing a song, a lot what Brother Osborne's been talking about, and it says, I am loved. Give them a hand, will you?
I am loved, I am loved, I can raise
I said, if you really knew me, you wouldn't want me. My scars are hidden by this mask I wear. But Jesus said, oh, my child, my scars go deeper. 'Cause it was love for you that put them there. That's why I can sing, I am loved, I am loved, so I can risk loving you. For the one who knows me best loves me.
Betty tonight from Laguna Hills is called. She's 59 years of age, has received Christ as her Savior and Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's see. Leonard in Los Angeles has come to the Lord, 37 years of age. I want to say something right here that's on my heart. People that have watched the program tonight, the testimonies that you've heard by Norval Hayes, the testimony you just heard by Charlie Osborne, these thrill you, make you laugh, make you cry, make you say, praise God, God is good. But there's something the Spirit of God impressed me to say. We can take courage from it, encouragement from it.
and say, thank God he did it for them. And if you're not careful, that'll be as far as it goes. Because you're going to have to get it to working in your life for yourself. Just because we've heard it tonight doesn't make it automatic in the lives of our loved ones. Get it working. Do what Narvel did in the home. Stand in the gap. Amen. Go through that home through the power of the Spirit and take authority over demon forces.
Amen.
And you wives, from what Charles has said tonight, well, by his own admission, he wasn't the easiest person in the world to live with. But when God got through with him, he changed his life. And his wife is... What's she think about you now? What does she think you're a pretty good guy, I guess, huh?
She's waiting for me to come home. You know, let me say something about my wonderful wife. She lived a horrible life for 10 years. Looking back on it, I really don't know how she did it, other than it was just by the grace of Almighty God. And in a spirit of desperation, I mean, when my kids would come home and say, Mom, why can't we have homes like other people? Why can't Dad love us like other families do? Why can't we have a family? And my wife, out of desperation, she said one night she laid on her pillow and she cried out to God because, see, we didn't know Jesus. Mm-hmm. We didn't know that we could cry out and God would hear us and that he would answer our prayer. We just didn't know that. Mm-hmm. But out of total desperation, my wife cried out, God, I can't take this anymore. Mm-hmm. I can't do this anymore. Lord, I can't change my husband. I've tried. Mm-hmm. For 20 years, I've tried to change my husband.
Yeah.
And I give him to you. I don't know what else to do with him, but just give him to you. And Dwight, 3 months later, I'm on my knees, tears running down my face, with God's Holy Spirit in my heart, and the love of Jesus becoming real in my mind and in my heart. It's an amazing thing what God can do when you can begin to love a person unconditional. I was on our 20th wedding anniversary. I was in South Florida. And I'm not going to tell you what I was doing, but I was in South Florida in a motel. And I deliberately did it, went to South Florida, just to upset my wife on our 20th wedding. I mean, I do things in spite, just to make you mad.
Yeah.
And my wife went to church that morning. It was on a Sunday morning, our 20th wedding anniversary. And she said, the choir began to sing, Let There Be Peace. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Mm-hmm. And she said something clicked in her heart. That she knew that she could never give me peace, but she could have peace. And in Mass that Sunday morning, she gave her life to Jesus. The only way she knew how, she was on her knees. She said, Lord Jesus, today I decide to love my husband just the way he is. And I don't know how she found me, but she called me on the telephone. And my phone rang and I picked it up. And she says, I don't care who you're with. I don't care how long you stay. I just want you to know that I love you. Mm-hmm. Now, if she had said, boy, when you come back to this town, I'm going to tack your hide to the wall. I've got three lawyers waiting on you. When you cross that Bay Bridge coming into Pensacola, you're my, I'm going to skin you. When I get through with you, there won't be nothing left but your shoes. But she didn't say that. Because I could have handled that. I could have said yes, and I got three lawyers. But she said, no. She says, I love you. And Dwight, I'm going to tell you, you can't do nothing with love but receive it. That's all you can do,
yeah,
is to receive it. And that was the beginning of my conversion. The day that she told me, she didn't care who I was with, how long I'd stay, what I was doing, that she loved me unconditionally, and she hung up on me. And 3 months later, I'm on my face begging God to forgive me, begging her to forgive me, begging my children to forgive me, begging my neighbors to forgive me, begging everybody to forgive me. And God healed my soul. God healed my life. So my message to the world is that God is love.
Yeah.
And anyone that lives in love lives in God, and God lives in him. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love never takes offense. And the great constitution of God, the great Magna Carta, love your enemy. Matthew 10:36 says, a man's enemy will be those members of his own household. And today the great war in this nation is not with Nicaragua. It's not with El Salvador. It's not with Russia. It's not with China. It's not with Japan. It's in our own homes. Satan has devoured and destroyed our homes because we can't love one another. And I pray to God tonight that as we begin to love our enemies, those members of our own household, because some of you are going to wake up tomorrow morning and your greatest enemy is laying right next to you. And Jesus said, love them. Be patient. Be kind. Don't be offended. And offer them up to the Lord Jesus and say, Lord Jesus, I can't change my husband. I can't change my kids. Lord, let me look at them through your eyes. Let me see them through faith. Let me be healed so I can love them the way you love them.
Yes.
I see thousands of families that are being healed.
Yeah, that's
amen.
Right.
All over the United States.
Amen.
Unconditional love is something that overcomes evil.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I praise God tonight for his mercy and his grace to a sinner, me. Hallelujah.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Yeah. We're going to pray for people. I feel like the time is right for us to pray for people that need a miracle of God in their body. Norval, what do you feel led of the Lord? That's one of the things we were going to touch earlier. Let's talk about that a little bit if we can. About healing.
Yes.
Divine healing.
Divine healing is absolutely wonderful. If people believe it, they'll just come to the Lord Jesus. The thing about divine healing is, right, you got to be at the right spot at the right time. Now, there is such a thing as, you know, God heals people different ways. I mean, he heals our mind and so forth, you know, but I'm talking about physical healing. He heals them different ways. The number one way you can be healed, as far as I can find in the scriptures, is get it like blind Bartimaeus got it. Just get it on your own, just you and Jesus. Just crying out to him and just putting your faith in him and the Lord being pleased. See, once your faith pleases God, you'll be healed. See, a lot of people don't know that. They just say, well, once I tell them, the Lord won't heal me. I said, well, once your faith pleases him, he'll heal you. Just check up on the scriptures. Blind Bartimaeus' faith pleased the Lord. And he stopped dead in his tracks and commanded that man that's hollowing to come here. And he told him, he says, your faith has healed you.
Yeah.
And his eyes popped open.
Yeah.
Jesus said, your faith has healed you.
Yeah.
And there is such
he
a thing.
He kept crying out.
Yeah, he kept on and on.
Well, it couldn't get him quiet.
Oh, yeah, he wouldn't stay quiet. When you seek the Lord to that degree, when you seek Jesus the healer to that degree, you're going to find Jesus the healer.
Yeah.
You're going to find him. I was speaking at a minister's conference in my own seminar in Daytona Beach, Florida, just a few days ago. And somebody came up to me at the banquet and says, well, Norval, he said, there's a woman here, a woman and a man came here. They're from New York. And she's from the First Baptist Church, and she got healed in your service 14 years ago. I said, oh, really? He said, yeah. And she was MS, multiple sclerosis. She had no hope for her. And she's sitting here today over at that table, and she's normal. And I said, oh, I remember when I went to there at the First Baptist Church in New York 14 years ago. And because when you're invited to the First Baptist Church, right, you pray about what you, once you know about healing, then you pray about what you want to speak on. So I was praying that day, you know, what I'm going to speak on. God, I'm willing to tell these Baptist people, because I helped build the First Baptist Church. I've been Baptist all my life. So I'll tell them anything you want me to tell them, Jesus. And I was praying and trying to get a message from God. And then while I'm praying, trying to get a message from God, the Lord told me, says, take your all with you. I said, take my all with me. What for? He said, you know what for. They don't have any. He said, take your all with you. I said, what do you want me to speak on, Lord? He said, you know what it is. I said, you mean you want me to teach James 5:14, James 5:15 in the church? He said, you got it. So I was staying in a Pentecostal home. They had a teenage daughter. And I said, young lady, I said, are you going to the service tonight? She said, you speaking in the First Baptist Church? She says, I wouldn't miss it. Are you kidding me? See, that's going to be better than television. It's got to be better than TV. I said, well, okay, you have a little bottle of oil here? She said, yes. I said, so bring the oil with you. Tonight, when I called you up, I said, I want you to come up and take the oil off and follow me. She says, Brother Norval, what are you going to do? I said, none of your business, just bring the oil. So I spoke that night on James 5:14 and 15 and brought her up and began to anoint people with oil. But this lady got up, I said, is there a lady here last week? I said, is there a lady here at this banquet that got healed 14 years ago in New York when I was there? She said, yes, that's me. I says, well, I've never met you before. I says, come up and tell us what happened. She says, well, I was an MS. She says, multiple sclerosis. She says, I saw double and everything. I couldn't do anything. My life was shambled, wrecked forever. It was forever, forever, forever. And they got me in that service where you was at. And you walked up to me with a bottle of oil. And you said to me, do you believe the Lord can heal you? And she said, yes, I believe it. I said, it's not come, I believe it. He says, well, the Lord's going to heal you tonight. And you anointed me with oil in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you anointed me with oil, you said, now arise and walk. And you walked off. And she said, I rose up. And she says, here I am, totally normal.
Hallelujah. Praise God.
Now, see, that's what you call. That's what you call being at the right spot at the right time, Dwight. Now, your faith can heal you in the living room. If you'll turn your face toward heaven, Jesus, you are my healer, and confess him as your healer. Thank you, Lord, for healing me. You are healing me now, Jesus. Faith is right now. Thank you, Lord, for healing me. Your mighty power is healing me now. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for healing me. You are my healer. And you do it all, I mean, do it for an hour every day, morning, noon, and night. Do it. Now, if you'll do that, anybody that's sick, right, will do that in their own living room. The healing power of God will come to them and heal them. They say, well, when will it come? It'll come as soon as you please the Lord. And if you sit around in your living room with cancer or some disease, and you sit there and you say, God, I believe in your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. I believe he's a Savior. I believe he's a healer. And I believe he's a miracle worker. And thank you, Lord, because I'm saved. But the doctor says I'm dying of the disease and I need to be healed. So I'm putting my faith in Jesus the healer. Jesus, you are my healer, and I thank you for healing me. Jesus, I thank you for healing me. You are my healer. And Jesus, you are healing me now.
Amen.
The price has already been paid by your stripes, but I'm accepting it. Your healing power is flowing through me now to heal me. Now, the Lord will heal anybody like that.
Amen.
I don't care if they're MS, crippled, blind, lame. I don't care what they are. Eyesight will come to them.
Amen.
The crooked legs will stretch out. If they do that continually, all the time, all the time, all the time, it'll come. They say, well, when will it happen? It'll happen as soon as the Lord is pleased and he listens to your confession and he watches you. The Lord watches you. I can prove it to you by the New Testament that Jesus watches your faith and he listens to your voice. He watches your faith. As soon as he is pleased, he will manifest himself and you'll be healed. I'm telling you, you'll be healed. Or if you're at the right spot at the right time, Dwight, somebody would anoint you with oil
and you'll be healed. And if you're dry spot at the right time, if somebody has the right kind of anointing in their hands, you like this, in Jesus' name, receive your healing. And that healing power can absolutely go down through your body and heal you. The Holy Spirit will operate on you. Jesus, twice, is the best surgeon I ever met. I watch him. I don't talk about something I hear about. I watch him operate on people all the time.
Could I share an experience? When I gave my life to Jesus and I listened to people like Norval Hayes and Dwight Thompson and Kenneth Copeland and Father John Bertolucci and these guys praising and proclaiming this, I called up Father Smith. I said, Father Smith, can I do what these guys do? I wanted to know if I could do it. Nobody never told me I could do it.
What did he say?
He said, Charlie, you can do it. And I got so excited, Norval, I left my restaurant, jumped in my car and went to the county nursing home. And I started going from room to room, in the name of Jesus, be healed. In the name of Jesus, be healed. And nobody got healed. And I go back the next day, in the name of Jesus, be healed. I'd wait for the nurses to get off on one side so that they wouldn't catch on to what I was doing. And Norval, I did that for a whole year. And I never saw, they'd die on me. I mean, I'd lay hands on them, they'd die. And one day I said, well, God, you ain't going to use me to heal. I'm just going to quit. I mean, people see me coming, they'd hide. Because, you know, they say, this guy, he's healing us dead, you know. And I walked in the nursing home one day and I'd made up. I said, this is it. I ain't going no more. One of the nurses came up to me and she said, are you the guy that just prays over everybody in this place? I said, yeah, but I promise you I'm not doing it no more. I quit. And she said, well, before you quit, there's a lady down here in room 502 that wants you to pray for her. I said, you mean somebody's asking for me to come and pray? Now, this woman was totally... distorted. She had a muscle disease that there was no muscle left in her body. Her jaw had dropped out of socket. Mm-hmm. I mean, her jaw wouldn't even stand, you know. Her heart was so bad that when they'd roll her over, she'd almost die. It would just, you know, jump around and wouldn't work right. And my wife and I walked in there and I thought, my God, here's another one of these hopeless cases. Just in passing, I said, Lord, you know, whatever you can do for this old dried up, shriveled up, fixing to die woman, I said, just do it. And we walked on out.
If that woman had known your track record, she wouldn't have
been. She'd have never. Well, she was desperate. Yeah. She was. Well, now, 6 months later, you ever heard of a guy named, a guy from Little Rock, Arkansas? Happy Caldwell.
Oh, yeah.
Did you ever hear Happy? Yeah. Well, he was putting on a prosperity seminar, and I really needed some prosperity because I was going down the hill fast. I mean, it was all going that away, and I was going that away. Yeah. And so I went to this seminar, and when I walked in, it was at the Holiday Inn, and I was a brand new Christian. I was a year old, and this elderly, attractive lady ran across the room and jumped in my arms and began to kiss me. I don't mean just little kisses. I mean, buddy, she was planting them all over me. And I'm standing there I'm froze. I said, oh, my God, whatever. Yeah. And I was at a Holiday Inn, my old hangout, and I didn't know what I'd walked into. And my wife was standing beside me, and she was in my arm. She had her legs wrapped around me.
That don't look good.
I just don't look good. And she said, do you remember me? I said, no, ma'am. She said, oh, you remember me? I said, no, ma'am, I don't. She looked over at my wife. She said, do you remember me? I said, yeah, mama, do you remember her? And my wife looked at her and said, I don't remember either. And she pulled a picture out of her pocketbook, and it was that old, dried up, shriveled up, cranked up lady laying in a county nursing home that they'd wrote off. And she was Hallelujah. Brother, you imagine what that done to my faith?
Amen.
I mean, Hallelujah. Brother, listen. That moved my faith. But I can imagine now the first time that
you
I ever...
You started in the healing work again, didn't you?
Well, you know, I realized... well, I didn't know how to use oil. That come later. I watched Norval one day taking out oil and slapping. Some guys was pouring it on. I said, I'm going to try that. Yeah. And you know, it works.
Oh, no,
it works. And,
well, it works
we ought to be the happiest people in the world. God's given us life.
Amen.
We've got eternal life. We've got the power to heal. We've got the joy of love in our hearts. We've got sin and death removed from us. We ought to just absolutely swarm this world.
Yeah.
If we really believe what we got, and if it's really real, if God's really true, I mean, we ought to just swarm the world.
Well, let's pray now.
Let's do it.
Let's do it right now.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We're praying now, right now. We have a wonderful, wonderful, dear lady named Brenda that needs a miracle of God tonight. Yes. Brenda, we're praying for you, and we want you to know that. Brother Norval, you lead us right now in the name of Jesus. You that need a miracle in your body, let me suggest if there's somebody close to you,
Hallelujah.
Join hands as an agreement. Get in agreement with somebody. If there's no one there with you, just reach out, if you will, toward the television screen. There's no magic to the screen, and there's nothing spiritual about touching a television screen. It's really more of an outward commitment of an inward faith.
Amen.
That's really why you're doing it. Just believe God right now. Norval?
Father, in Jesus' name, we lay our hands on all these requests tonight. We reach our hand out to the screen tonight,
Lord,
out
we
to
believe
the camera.
We're in agreement.
We pray that your healing power will go in those bodies, and I agree with them. That disease will disappear. Satan, take your hand off of those bodies. Those bodies belong
Hallelujah.
To God, not you.
No.
You have no right to them.
No authority.
Thank you, Jesus, for your healing power going into those bodies.
Yes.
Driving out all symptoms of affliction in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord, for special miracles for those that need it. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus, you love them and you are their healer. Nobody else. You, Jesus, are their healer. And we agree that your healing power go to them right now and give them a healing and a cure in Jesus' name. And we thank you for doing it.
Hallelujah.
And we agree together, it is done.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You know, Norval, before the Hawaiians sing, get in agreement with me. And I'm going to ask folks everywhere just to get in agreement with me right now. When I get through with this program tonight, I do some taping. And then I leave next Monday for the nation of Brazil.
Amen.
Got some very important, large meetings there.
Wonderful.
Tens of thousands will be in those meetings. And I just want you to pray. I just feel led of God to ask you to get in agreement with me.
Oh, yes. All right.
Dwight, my son, and a couple of the crew folks from our office are going with us and going with me. And I'm just believing God that we're going to see a miracle of souls.
Isn't that wonderful?
Tremendous miracle of souls in the nation of Brazil.
Amen.
So let's get in agreement if we can right now.
Oh, Father, in Jesus' name, Lord, we bring Dwight Thompson before thee right now, before the throne of God. And we ask you, Lord, as Dwight makes his way to Brazil to hold those large crusades for those people, we pray the Spirit of God would go to Brazil now and begin to draw them into those big stadiums where thousands will come and hear the preached gospel. Father, in Jesus'
Lord,
name,
we do
tonight,
ask in Jesus
I reach
name.
Out and lay my hands on Dwight, and
Hallelujah.
I ask you that a special anointing come upon
I
him,
receive
Lord,
it, Father,
as he stands in Brazil and preaches. I pray,
Hallelujah.
Lord, that you let him speak like a man from another world. Give him the words from heaven to say
Hallelujah.
To Brazil in Jesus' name. We agree together in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that your saving power and your healing power will flow from Dwight like a river in Jesus' name. And Lord, let your mighty power go with all of his crew and protect them and bring them back home safely and make them a blessing to Brazil in Jesus'
let
name.
It be, Lord.
Let thy spirit, Lord, turn Brazil upside down. Let sin flee from that place and the glory of God and the peace of God go in those people's hearts and minds and bodies in Jesus' name. We claim it for thousands and thousands of souls for Brazil in Jesus'
we
name.
Receive it.
Amen.
Amen. We receive it. Praise God. Praise God. Let's everybody praise the Lord for what he's done tonight. It's been a wonderful night tonight. Well, the Hawaiians are ready to sing for us right now. They're going to sing a couple of songs for us, and then we'll come back with a final word. It's been a pleasure tonight to have Charlie Osborne, such a blessing and such a fireball.
Amen.
From Pensacola, Florida, and our wonderful dear friend, Brother Narvel Hayes, and his powerful, dynamic, anointed, devil-stomping ministry. I believe every time Narvel gets up out of bed, I believe the devil says, "All right, everybody, you wake up. Here he comes again." And the Hawaiians have been such a tremendous blessing. Let's give them a big hand. They're going to sing a couple of songs for us right now. They'll bless your heart. The Hawaiians. Mark and Diane.
Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land, I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, bread of heaven, bread of heaven.
Songs of praise. Beautiful. The Hawaiians, they have, I don't know how many albums they have. I know they have a number of albums. Do we have any on slides tonight or not? I don't know. Be sure and go to your Christian bookstores and request albums by the Hawaiians. They'll bless your heart and bless your life. Thanks for being here tonight, Mark and Diane. You're just tremendous.
Amen.
Well, Narvel, it's been good to have you. And Charles, yes, it's been good to have you.
Praise God. Brother.
Final words.
Well, I'd like to say hello to a ex-junkie in Phoenix that delivered and saved by the Lord Jesus Christ. His name is Mike Thompson. 2 years ago, he was watching me on television. And Mike, praise God for your testimony. He was just sentenced 2 weeks ago. He's just really heavy into drugs. And the judge gave him a suspended sentence. And he's going to be preaching with me.
Good.
And God's raising up people that's been in the bottom. Mm-hmm. And just, they got nothing left to live for but Jesus.
Yeah.
And I just praise God for an opportunity to bring people into this.
I think you need your mic on here. They tell me we did not. That thing fell off there.
Didn't hear any of it.
Yeah, let me say it just quickly again then. To Mike Thompson of Phoenix, really love you, brother. We'll see you next week. I'll see you Monday. We'll be in Phoenix for 3 weeks. We'll be going from one Catholic church to another, all over Phoenix, preaching Jesus, raising the dead, opening blind eyes.
Old-fashioned Holy Ghost.
We're going to have a camp meeting. Nice. We're going to start out at a little Catholic church in Scottsdale, Our Lady of Perpetual Help. We're going to do some foot stomping in there. And
you're going to take the oil with you?
Yeah, we're going to take the oil.
Yes, amen.
Father McGuire's got the oil waiting.
Oh, that's great. Great to have you tonight. Narvel, you've got about 1 or 2 minutes, I think.
Okay. Well, I'd like to tell the people down in Florida, Dwight, that we're going to have a great Thanksgiving convention at my motel down in Florida, the Hayes Motel in Crystal River, Florida, with Benny Hinn and Mike Williams and myself. And the first week in December, we'll be at Palm Springs. With me and Shambach will be there all week. So if you'd like to get in on that, you can. And what was your daughter's name?
Regina.
How many years ago was she got saved?
8 years ago.
Regina, hello, honey. I'm glad you came to Jesus that night in Pensacola, Florida.
Amen.
And you came and let the Lord give the Lord Jesus Christ a chance at your life. And I'm glad you're set free from dope. And I'm going to say I thank God for you, Zona. Just keep giving your testimony,
Amen.
Honey. Thank you for letting the Lord set you totally free. And you're off of drugs. And now you've returned to Jesus. And your daddy's a little sweet girl. And it's so good to have you free, Zona. God bless you, honey.
Amen.
Bless you.
I want to say hello to my mom and my daddy and my three grandchildren, Chad and Cody and
Amen.
Austin. The fourth one that's on the way.
What
I
about
just
you?
Thank
Amen.
God. Hello, all of you.
What about you? You got a dog?
No, it's gone now. He's away from, not with us anymore. Thank you, Hawaiians, for being here tonight. Paul and Jen will be hosting tomorrow night. I don't know who their guests are, but I know it'll be a great night, and it'll be an exciting time. Don't forget, we're expecting a great praise-a-thon that comes up the week of, I don't know what week it is. It's next week, I think, isn't it? Somebody help me out. It's... Pardon me?
10th
through the 14th. Thank you. That must have been the Lord told me that. Just heard that voice. Hey, 10 through 14.
I'd like to give a word of thanks to Paul and Jan Crouch for keeping this television station, this television ministry like it is. It's open and free.
Amen.
It's not bound up, you know, for 2 or 3 minute testimony. Just you can explain what God would like to do for the human race. And the Spirit of God is moving so strong and sweet here tonight. I'm so glad that Paul and Jan would... Let this television ministry stay like this, be free.
Amen. We are too. We praise God for them. You'll be preaching Sunday night at 6 p.m. at the Victory Christian Center in Palm Springs, California.
Yes, I will.
So Narvel Hayes will be preaching in Palm Springs, 6 o'clock p.m. in Palm Springs, where Pastor Jeff Walker is doing a great job down there in that city. Well, thank you for being with us tonight, one and all, and we love you. We really do. And remember, let everything that hath breath just keep on praising the Lord. Good night, everybody.
We're so glad you you've been with us for Praise the Lord. If you'd like an audio cassette of Praise the Lord, please write and ask for program 1029-86. That's 1029-86. The tapes will be sent for your love gift to the Praise the Lord program. TBN has a worldwide ministry. We need your love gifts, large or small, to help keep the gospel of Jesus Christ going around the world. So write today, Praise the Lord, P.O. Box A, Santa Ana, California, 92711. Or in Canada, write TBN, P.O. Box 23517, Vancouver, AMF, Vancouver, British Columbia, V7B1W2. If you haven't asked Christ into your life, call our prayer partner now and pray to receive Jesus as Savior and Lord. This is Jim McClellan saying, God bless you. And remember, let everything that hath breath praise the Lord.
This program was brought to you by the prayers and contributions of our faithful partners throughout the United States of America.